Welcome to Paul or Nothing, the place to get all of your Paul, all of the time. Join me, your host Sam Wiles, as we discover the history, the music, and the man behind it all, Paul McCartney. To get in contact with the show, email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com.
Hello, hello, hello. Hi, hi, hi. The night is young and welcome to another episode of Paul or Nothing, the place to get all of your Paul, all of the time. I am, of course, your host, Sam Wiles. And remember, this is wide screen podcasting. Thank you all for listening, and I hope you're all well, safe, and sound. So, this is going to be a strange episode today, folks. During the first lockdown in the summer of 2020, me and Her Majesty Kit O'Toole got together to do an episode on the movie Give My Regards to Broadstreet. Of course, all of you listening to this show will likely know who she is already. She is the co-host of Talk More Talk, a solo Beatles podcast, as well as having made appearances all over the podcasting scene. She's also an author whose works include The Songs We Were Singing, Guided Tours Through the Lesser Known Songs of the Beatles, which is a book titled Right After My Heart. And I really must reinforce how much I was looking forward to doing this episode. Not only because Kit is really knowledgeable, but because she's one of the kindest, most giving podcast guests I've ever heard. She's a real laugh, and I knew we were going to have a blast recording this. She was also going to be the first woman I ever had on the show at that point, which was cool. And I also knew she had a whole lot of strong opinions about the movie in question. The recording itself went swimmingly. I'd like to think she had a blast too. I'd like to think she remembers that time as well. But then why didn't the episode come out? Again, I'm sure I've mentioned this on the pod at some point, but at that time on that day, my Skype recorder technology had failed, and this was before I had adopted Zoom here on the show, and so we had to settle on Kit recording the conversation, the audio, on her end. This was fine, except for the fact that whatever system Kit was using was only able to record one audio channel, which normally would be fine. You know, I've edited similar episodes before, it's clunkier and it means you can't edit out instances of people talking over each other, for example. But the kicker, for me at least, was the wind and the background audio. Yes, I'm sure it was lovely for Kit to sit outside on a bright ass day doing a podcast with me. However, the audio just, it wasn't usable. You know, you can hear the wind, especially when I'm talking, and it's not like I could just edit out Kit's audio whilst I was speaking. You know, it's not what I wanted, and so it was instantly shelved, which is a shame. And there were subsequent attempts to revive this project, like McCartney and Hot Hits and Cold Cuts, but again, with all the audio errors and maladies that I could still hear, it still did not meet the regular Paul or Nothing standard, whatever that is, and remained on the shelf. Then, months pass, I get this new computer, and whilst transferring over some files, I find this raw audio. And at that point, the Patreon was finally up and off its arse, and so I decided to upload this lost episode, as it would be the perfect kind of bonus material for the patrons. And for a couple of months, this episode has indeed sat dormant, only heard by a select privileged paying few, aka the patrons. However, subsequently, after a poll on the Patreon, it was decided by all these wonderful folk who give me money every month that it was good enough for all of you to hear now. So make sure you thank them, maybe even thank them in the comments of the Patreon page by, you know, subscribing to it. But again, before the plugs, I gotta say, I don't think that this is going to be the official Broadstreet episode. I don't think this is going to be the official article. And I may still very well re-record this with Kit herself in the future for the sake of posterity and my own perfectionism. Who knows? Maybe it'll be interesting to see how we do the second time around. As, you know, this isn't going to be the first time I've reattempted to record the same podcast with the same script, albeit never with a year plus gap in between recordings. To further make this point, there will be no briefing or introduction segment at the start of this episode explaining all the need-to-know cliff notes concerning the film version of Give My Regards to Broadstreet, We will again shine our ever-loving living light on this topic, and when we do, I promise I'll dish out all the details. But yeah, this really is going to be something a little bit different today, folks, and I hope you all enjoy it for what it is, as my kindly paying patrons certainly decided unanimously that not only was it fit for release, but it was good enough for consumption as is, with no further edits or attempts to cut out my awful stutter. This hasn't been edited past around the first 15-minute mark, which, as I say, is the point where I did try to salvage the episode originally. But besides that, this is going to be the most uncut, raw, get-back-esque, wildlife-esque, unplugged, official bootleg-style episode of Paul or Nothing that you're ever going to get, folks. Even I haven't listened to the audio this time around, and I will apologise now, not only for the audio quality, but for any jokes that are bad, any jokes in poor taste, and for any time I rudely interrupt the Majesty herself, Kit O'Toole. But before we can do any of that, we must first settle on the matter of the housekeeping. So, what do we have in terms of news today, everyone? Well, first of all, we've had some new Paul McCartney merch drop. Yes, on the 1st of May 2021, with no official press release or even a post on his own website to announce it, we have been gifted with these limited edition three imagined goodie boxes, rather reminiscent of the McCartney 3 coloured box sets. And I say three imagined, because on McCartney's own website, it's listed as McCartney 3 imagined box sets, which is just mental. But yeah, without getting too bogged down in this title yet again, let me first describe the contents. We have a black short sleeve t-shirt, both a white and black long sleeve top, each with unique designs, a McCartney 3 imagined notebook and pencil set, custom multicolour McCartney 3 imagined dice sets and a tin, four dice Polaroid prints, and an online store exclusive mini jacket CD edition of 3 imagined. Now, whilst I am a little miffed that I am having to pay for the dice that I kind of wish I'd gotten for free as a promotion, I'm still going to say that this is quite the haul, and one that is admittedly perfect for doting mega fans with more cash than sense. Like, there really isn't anything all that great of substance here, but it does feel like it's filling a gap. You know how a lot of people were kind of expecting that fabled casino edition of McCartney 3 with dice and stuff like that? A lot of this stuff feels like, you know, the content that would have been in that box set had it existed. That being said, though, the fact that all of this stuff isn't trapped behind a price wall of £500+ or $700+ is certainly a step in the right direction for Macca's current marketing team. Like, yeah, we didn't need this any more than we needed a dozen or so pressings of McCartney 3 or 3 imagined, but I am glad that the average Joe and Jane can now get their hands on this stuff without breaking the bank. Not only that, but if you don't like the clothing or the extra bonus goodies, then you can buy them separately. Again, much better for everyone involved. Of course, it's all still too expensive, and the fact that it's £85 for the entire merch set should be enough to get a large majority of the fanbase worked up as per the normal, and in principle, yes, I kind of agree that's probably about $20 too much. But when you think about the merch Paul charges when he's at a venue on tour, then you can see how some of this stuff in this bundle is quite the steal. And for the sake of true transparency, I do have to be honest and say, no, I can't go on a huge socialist rant about this one, mostly because my kind and loyal patrons out there have indeed paid for this one for me. Yes, folks, thanks to my loyal fan base and wonderful listeners and even more wonderful patrons, not only have I been able to buy a gold exclusive copy of McCartney 3, I've been able to get RAM on the half-speed edition, and now this £85 merch set. I've been saving the Patreon funds for a while now, and it's just great to have such a period of gluttonous expenditure. Like, you know, this really is, you know, consumerism at its peak, and if it was my money, I probably wouldn't be doing a lot of this stuff, but you know, I like to have stuff to review for the show, and if I'm not putting it into a new mic, getting guests on the show, or paying, you know, the hosting fees, then hell yeah, I am going to get this set purely under the guise of reviewing it for all you out there. Hey, maybe I can even get it written off on my tax as well. Oh, speaking of free dice, now that, you know, all of you wonderful patrons out there have indeed got me the Ram half-speed album and the £85 merch set from McCartney's site specifically, do you think I will finally qualify to receive the next lot of free promotional merch the next time Paul releases something? Let's hope so, eh? Right, on to some other news. At the time of recording, Dominic Fike is set to perform his version of The Kiss of Venus from Three Imagined on The Late Late Show with James Corden in only a few hours. So if you are listening to this episode on day of release, be sure to check out Dominic's performance live tonight. I'd love to hear your thoughts, and I'll let you know next time in the next news segment. And finally, a new director's cut of the iconic performance of While My Guitar Gently Weeps at the 2004 posthumous induction of George Harrison has been released. You know the video, I'm sure, folks. It's the one featuring Tom Petty, Jeff Lynne, Steve Winwood, Danny Harrison, and finally Prince doing the showstopper guitar solo at the end. In this new cut, we basically just get more footage of Prince doing that, as the broadcast version was a little more democratic with its cuts. And here, by the end, it is just a Prince music video, and it's pretty glorious. Go check it out. I'll pop a link down below. And that's it for the news, folks. So let's crack on with the plugs. To get in contact with the show, email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. I always love reading out your Paul McCartney stories here on the show, whether you've met the man, been to his shows, anything special events, maybe you know some fact or factoid, you want to talk about one of my reviews in the past, talk about an album in the future, correct a mistake I've made, maybe you just want to say hi. Whatever it is at all, drop us an email at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. For more day-to-day updates and for instant access, follow us on our Twitter page, which is @McCartneyPod. We always have lots of fun over there, folks. For more bonus Paul or Nothing content, if you can't get enough of Paul or Nothing and you want some extra stuff in the written word format, check out our blog, our sister blog, at paulmccartneypod.wordpress.com. Follow us on our socials. Find us on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube by typing in Paul or Nothing or Paul McCartney Podcast. Be sure to check out the YouTube page for exclusive Paul or Nothing highlight episodes. And if you want to help out the show right away, if you want to help us out right now in a way that takes less than 30 seconds, please leave us a review, whether it's on iTunes, on your podcasting app, on YouTube itself. If you can find it in your heart to leave us a thumbs up or a nice little review, maybe even a nice little comment, then it would certainly be most appreciated by myself here, folks. And I've just got to give a little shout out to everyone who has given us a positive rating recently. I had five-star ones this week, which is... yeah, that always puts a smile on your face, right? But if you want to help out the show directly, folks, if you want to help see the show grow, if you want to help get new equipment, or maybe you just want to help keep the lights running and pay the hosting fees, then please check out our Patreon page. As I'm sure you know by now, Patreon is the way that you, the public, can support independent content creators such as myself by throwing a couple of dollars at my face every month down the internet. You know, this episode today was brought to you by Patreon. All of the merch that I am waiting for to come in the post was all paid for via the Patreon. And that's basically it, folks. It all just goes right back into the show. And it's not all for naught. You're not just giving me money willy-nilly. You get instant access to all sorts of bonus content. You get finished episodes 2 days before everyone else. You get instantly uploaded full video interviews and podcasts that I do that can sometimes be uploaded weeks before the episode itself. There's also other exclusive video content. You get access to all the notes and scripts I use for episodes, and you also get little bonus stuff like this, lost episodes of Paul or Nothing, or weird edits that I found in the vaults, that kind of thing. If you're enjoying the show, if you like the fact that there are no ads here, if you want to help see us grow, then please consider joining our Patreon family, which includes such wonderful folks as Moti Riber, Christian Perry, Richard Driver, Chris Atkinson, Richard Binnington, Mr. B, Teresa Brader, Stephanie Miller, Lou DiLeonardo, Cheryl McCoy, Katrina S, Sam Hode, Anastasia L, Robert Carabelli, Warren Butson, and Matt Phillips. Right, folks, we are indeed about to crack on with the lost, resalvaged episode of Paul or Nothing, where we cover Give My Regards to Broadstreet with Kit O'Toole. Just as a little disclaimer, like I say, not in terms of, you know, my guest content or my content or anything said, just in terms of the actual audio quality itself, this isn't up to the usual spec of Paul or Nothing. So if you are a new listener, maybe you're one of Kit's fans, then please check out some of our other recent episodes to see how the show is supposed to sound. But anyway, rather nervously, rather trepidatiously, I'm going to say, let's get right into it, folks. 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Welcome to Paul or Nothing, the place to get all of your Paul, all of the time. Join me, your host, Sam Wiles, as we discover the history, the music, and the man behind it all, Paul McCartney. To get in contact with the show, email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com.
And now that we've gotten the housekeeping out of the way, it's high time I introduce to you the poor soul that I've roped into discussing this cinematic nuclear fallout. My guest today is proudly known within the Beatles podcasting community as the Queen. I will call her Her Majesty throughout. You will no doubt have heard her as the co-host on the solo Beatles video slash podcast Talk More Talk, of which she's the final member we have actually had on this show. And, of course, her credits also stretch far and wide, covering, but not limited to, When We Was Fab, Things We Said Today, Glass Onion on John Lennon, and The John Lennon Hour. Not only that, but she's also an author, and she's clearly a woman after my own heart, because in 2015 she released the incredibly insightful book called Songs We Were Singing, Guided Tours Through the Lesser-Known Beatles Songs, and it shines a light on all the songs that Beatle and solo Beatles fans should be discussing, but aren't. Everybody out there, please give it up for Her Majesty, Dr. Kit O'Toole. Kit, welcome to the show. How's it going, my friend?
Oh, I'm doing great, Sam. It is so good to be here. I've loved your show. And at last we meet, my friend.
No, this has been in the pipeline for at least a year, and I'm glad I've finally pulled my finger out, if I'm really honest. Have you been enjoying the apocalypse?
It's been an interesting year, hasn't it? It's really been quite the time, and so far I've been safe and sound, so I hope you've been healthy as well.
Yes, I've already got my antibodies. I've got a family of doctors, so I caught it pretty early on. Don't worry, folks. You can't catch it through your headphones. Achoo!
I've got my hand sanitizer. I'm all good.
Could you send it through Skype? That'd be really handy, actually.
Excellent.
I'd love to add up how much free hand sanitizer I've had over the COVID quarantine. Like, I'd love to work out the cash value that I've actually gotten out of this.
Yeah, you could make some good money with that right now.
Now, Kit, as always, I'd like to start these interviews off with the most British question ever. So, with that in mind, Kit, where are you calling from and what's the weather like?
Well, I am calling in from Clarendon Hills, Illinois, which is in the western suburbs of Chicago, and I'm actually broadcasting right now from my backyard. It is a beautiful day here. It is about, I'd say, like 90 degrees and sunny. It is a beautiful summer day in July. So if you hear some birds chirping or a lawnmower or something like that as we're talking here today, that's why, because I'm in my yard.
Just as a little aside, I'm a massive Tom Waits fan. How far are you from Johnsburg, Illinois?
Pretty far. That is probably a good couple of hours from here. So I admit I have never been there, but I certainly know of it. But that's kind of, that's kind of out in the country from where I am. But I'll have to try and make it out there one of these days. Tom Waits is quite a talent. So great songwriter and quite a unique artist.
Not that I ever plug my Tom Waits podcast on this show, ever.
Oh, no, not at all.
I must admit, though, I thought when I was going to be interviewing Yanks for this podcast that it would just be LA and New York. And I'm so glad to see how homogenous and far-reaching the US Beatle podcasting community really is.
Oh, yeah, I mean, there are quite a number of us out here in Chicago that are Beatle geeks. And, you know, we, in fact, the Fest for Beatles fans, which unfortunately the Chicago convention will not be held this year due to the apocalypse. But we there are a number of us out here that have radio programs and, of course, podcasters and that sort of thing. So, yeah, there's a community of us out here. So yep, it's not just L.A. and New York. We're out here, too, doing our thing.
And, Kit, you're the first person on this show to have the common sense not to actually name those other podcasts and radio shows. So.
Well, you know, we're a little competitive. Just a little.
As per tradition, Kit, when I first have someone on the show, I like to gauge their general thoughts on the Beatles and the Fab Four. And while I don't want your answers to be short by any means, I do want the first thing that pops into your pretty little head, if you will.
Oh, nice. I see what you did there.
Oh, puns are going to be coming left, right and centre today. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
What? You know what? I'll actually change this question to be a little fairer. What is your favourite Beatles song today?
Oh, Tomorrow Never Knows.
That's two Tomorrow Never Knows in a row we've had now, actually.
Really?
Yeah, a very popular song, clearly. And it's one of the few songs from Revolver that McCartney did not drag out for this soundtrack that we're going to be talking about today. Do you have such thing as a least favorite Beatles song?
Oh, boy, that's the second time I've been asked that on a show recently. You know, I hate to say it, but probably Long, Long, Long. I have to be brutally honest here. It's probably the one I skip over, to be completely honest, when I'm listening to the White Album. I hate to admit it, although it really did sound great in the remix and remastering for the box set that came out a couple of years ago. I will admit that. It sounded great, but admittedly, not one of my favorites. I'm sorry, Sam. I'm sorry. Can I still do the show?
It was nice talking to you, Kit. It really was. This is why I haven't had a woman on the show. This is exactly why. You know what? I'm sorry, another kind of mind, but I'm sorry, Diana. You know, we're obviously going to have to skip that as well. Shout out to another kind of mind. They're my favourite pod at the moment. Kit, is there such thing as an overrated Beatles song to your ear?
Oh, gosh, that's hard to say. I don't know if I would say overrated, but I mean,
maybe overplayed?
Overplayed. I guess I would say I'm a little burned out on I Want to Hold Your Hand. I understand, of course, it's an important song in the Beatles canon, but I could go without hearing that for a while, you know.
After your comments about Long, 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 I'm certainly not going to be holding your hand. Do not worry about that.
I mean, we shouldn't be holding hands right now anyway.
Unless you've got one of those weird plastic walls that people are hugging each other through. Have you seen
that? Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I can't wait for McCartney's post-COVID McCartney 3 album that he must be working on.
Yeah, exactly.
Hopefully, though, maybe no racial slurs in the title of this one, you know? Hopefully.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. Just, yeah, be smarter this time.
Now, what is the most underrated or underplayed Beatles tune?
Oh, my goodness. Underrated or underplayed? Okay. I was just talking about this on another podcast recently. I'll be back.
Thank you. You're back in the game, Kit.
All right. I've redeemed myself. Yeah.
No one talks about it in terms of A Hard Day's Night. It's so good. The chords and the harmonies are incredible.
Yeah, I love the harmonies, and the chord changes are gorgeous, and I just think it also represents, and cheap plug coming, I talk about it in my book, Songs We Were Singing, that it also represents a turning point, in songwriting, too, that, you know, it really goes beyond just, She Loves You or I Want to Hold Your Hand, that it's really a story story about, you know, this sort of troubled relationship. And kind of interesting that it, also that the, you know, woman in some ways is in charge in this relationship. You know, that, that John is sort of placing himself in the position of, you know, that the, you know, woman is treating him badly, but he knows he'll be back again. You know, I mean, it's an interesting kind of change of roles. You've got those great harmonies. You've got the beautiful chord changes. It's just a real game changer, I think, in the Beatles and just a leap forward in artistry in many ways. And you never hear much about it. And, why?
Too long. Beatles for Sale and Help and the kind of Bob Dylan era of their songwriting. You're so right there.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you for saying that.
Good. I've redeemed myself. Excellent.
Like, let's talk about objectivity and, you know, not opinions. What is the best post-Beatles record?
Oh, best post-Beatles, boy, that is really tough because there are a number of candidates there. But I would say, and I hate to say this on a Paul McCartney podcast, but...
Plastic Ono Band, isn't it? You're going to say Plastic Ono Band.
No. Although that's a candidate. I mean, that's really a candidate. But I'll tell you, All Things Must Pass knocks me out. I mean, every time. I just think that is such an incredible statement that George made. That album is just so dense with with themes, and it must have. I mean, of course, I wasn't around when it first came out. I was born in 72, so I was it came out just a year before. But it must have just knocked people out when that came out, that people probably thought, where was George hiding all of this stuff? I mean, he covered so many different themes in that, you know, about spirituality. Of course, there was even one of the great Kiss-off songs, Wawa. There were just and you had so many different wonderful artists backing him up. It's personally a very moving record to me. And it's just gotten better with time. I think so. For personal reasons as well as objectively, I think that is the most impressive post-Beatles record. But boy, you know, close call though. Plastic Ono Band, I mean, that is a fantastic record. Band on the Run, I mean, what can you say? That is an incredible record as well. So, but I'd say by a hair, All Things Must Pass wins for me.
Well, I mean, thank God you didn't say Goodnight Vienna or something like that. All right!
I should have, just to shock you, but yes. Or Ringo the Fourth or something. I should have really shocked you.
Oh, I really wish his album titles weren't punchlines, but they just are, aren't they?
I know.
shout out to things we said today in the great 80th Ringo's birthday episode that just came out.
Yep. And actually, we Talk More Talk, we did an 80th birthday salute and talked about our favorite Ringo albums. And I will say, the Ringo album, that is some great pop. I mean, there were some fun songs on there. And Time Takes Time is worth checking out, too. His early 90s comeback album, that has some great tunes on it. So it's not in the same category, obviously, as All Things Must Pass or Band on the Run or anything, but at his best, his albums can be fun. You know, that.
Because, like, going back to All Things Must Pass just for a moment.
Yeah.
What I've noticed about that is every time you listen to it, you're like, oh shit, that song's on it as well. Oh, and this song's on it as well. Oh, it's like Thriller. It's like, oh my God, all of these songs are great. And you know all of them. Like, even if you don't know them offhand, like, oh, I've definitely heard it before somewhere. And
exactly.
Hit after hit after hit. And even like the more quieter songs, like the Ballad of Sir Frankie Crisp or something like that, it just stands up to the best of all the solo Beatles work. I really can't disagree with you there at all.
That's a good point, because yeah, you do. Yeah, as you listen to it, you're like, oh, I forgot this one was on there, and yeah, and there's so many different styles on it. It's just such an impressive work, just a masterpiece.
My favorite thing about it, though, is the interview with Phil Spector in Living in the Material World, where he's like, and then we had to go, where, and it's like, oh my God, this psychopath producer.
Yeah, can you, I know, isn't it amazing to think that yeah, such a psychopath could have produced something so beautiful like that? I mean,
couldn't he have been like a nice psychopath like David Byrne or something, you know?
Yeah, exactly. No kidding.
Oh my God, Tina Weymouth working with George Harrison as well. My God, that'd be fun as well. But we're not here to talk about my future Talking Heads podcast. Last one. Is your favorite Beatles film out of the main five?
I guess, you know what, I'm really torn, because I've always been torn between Hard Day's Night and Help, because for a storyline, for just, you know, I would say Hard Day's Night, because it's just from beginning to end, it was just the perfect. You know, I even hesitate to say jukebox movie, because I love how, I think it was Roger Ebert who coined it the Citizen Kane of jukebox movies, and it really was. I mean, it just really set a new standard. And even today, the sequences, the music sequences, I mean, they just set the standard for music video. The writing was sharp. And talking about George Harrison, I mean, I thought in some ways George Harrison was the best of, the acting in that. We're going to be talking about acting in just a few minutes.
He's great, isn't he?
Yeah, that scene with him and the I don't know how you describe it, but sort of the would-be fashion trendsetter. That scene is just marvelous. I love it. That's one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie. Plus, I love the scene too with the Beatles in the train with the older gentleman. I mean, to me, that even just sort of summarizes what was happening in the 60s of the clashes of the generations. It just there's so many wonderful scenes in that, but Help is a runner up, because it's not quite as good. The plot is silly and yes, the Beatles were stoned throughout the whole movie. I know all that stuff, but for a piece of pop art, It's a lot of fun, and it's very effective. The fashions. I mean, it's a really a snapshot of its time, and I appreciate it for that. But for a coherent storyline, if you want to call it that, I would have to go with A Hard Day's Night.
I've tried to warm to Help over the years. And after watching Give My Regards to Broadstreet, wow, I like Help a lot more.
well, yeah.
You know what, Kit? Let's press on. The most important question is, on a scale of 1 to 10, one being filled with rage and 10 being totally at peace with it, how upset are you that I didn't ask you to talk about a better topic today?
You know what? I mean, honestly, I'm not... enraged at all. I'm not, because I really had a lot of fun with this. I mean, I'm not enraged. Really, I'm really. I would say, a 7. Because I'm really. You're not such a bad boy at all. You might have no values, but you know.
God damn.
But no, this is really, it was fun to revisit this movie, seriously.
Now, let me ask you, let's do a bit of history here. So you would have been 12 when this came out then.
That's right.
Were you already a Beatles fan by the time Broadstreet was released in shops and cinemas?
Not a hardcore one yet. I was just starting to get into the Beatles. I do remember when this came out. I didn't see it in the theaters. I was, as I said, not quite into it yet. I did buy the album. I did buy the album, and I have the 45 to No More Lonely Nights. I did buy that at the time, because I absolutely remember seeing the video when it came out. I remember him, you know, doing making the press rounds and reading articles about it. So I was just kind of at the beginning of getting kind of interested in the Beatles.
I can't tell if that's like the best time or worst time to be a Beatles fan. Like, I mean... The 80s seems like, you know, for a guy like me who loves to be a contrarian and a hipster and going against the grain, I feel like I was born 20 years too early. I would have loved to have been, a hipster in the 80s going, actually, the Beatles are much better than Devo, actually.
Yeah, it was an interesting time. And, you know, and it was interesting how, you know, I got to... the Beatles, because really I got into them through Michael Jackson, because, you know, when I was that age, I mean, Michael was everywhere, you know, and of course he did all those duets with Paul,
as well.
Yes.
Jesus Christ. Like, he was better looking than all four Beatles combined. I'm going to say it right now.
Exactly. And so, you know, he was it. And so when he did The Girl Is Mine, and, you know, and of course I bought Thriller. I mean, I was a huge fan. And so then they did Say, and I bought my first Paul album through that. You know, I got Pipes Apiece. That was my very first Paul album, and that was through Michael.
First album as well. What a cracking first album to buy for Paul as well.
Yeah, exactly. That was my first. And you know, and I'm really glad you said that, because when I've said that to other fans, you know, particularly first generation, they say, oh, you know, what a horrible album to be introduced to, you know, through Paul. And I'm like, give me a break. I mean, it wasn't that bad.
So Bad, Pipes mm-hmm. of Peace, Average Person. Whoever says that to you, Kit, bring them round my way. I'll tell them to fuck off for you. No way.
Well,
how
thank you.
How dare they? Oh.
Seriously, though, I've been told, they're like, oh, that's the worst album. I'm like, give me a break. I don't think that's his worst album at all. I mean, there were some great moments on there. So, yeah. So, I mean, that was, you know, so I had kind of an interesting introduction to him. So, yeah. So by this time, I was kind of like, oh, I'm getting more interested in this Paul McCartney guy. and I mean, I knew who he was, but before that. But so that's when then I started buying a bit more of his stuff. So that's when Broadstreet came out. I loved No More Lonely Nights. That song really grabbed me when it first came out. And so then I bought the 45 and then bought the album. And Lonely Nights was a huge hit. I mean, huge hit back in the day.
Yeah, this is back when a huge hit could just be a top 10, not just
yes.
one, you know?
Yep, exactly. And that, and the video was everywhere. Now, I didn't get MTV at this point. Chicago was very slow in getting cable. So, I mean, I was watching it on, you know, other channels. But that video was played a lot. I mean, you know, it was, I mean, this movie was really being hyped at the time. I absolutely remember that.
Well, there's no reason why it shouldn't be. Like, it's awful that it turns out that fucking Harvey Me Too Weinstein was the bloke who helped co-finance and promote this film.
Yeah.
The obvious hashtag love me too.
Exactly. Yeah, I forgot that he was involved in this. Yeah, that's true. But oh yeah, and I remember
on it though. You know what I mean? Like, it was,
yeah,
A Hard Day's Night. It should have made 23-24 million at least in the American box office, and it might not even made enough money back to cover the cost of the ballroom dancing sequence.
Yeah. But I mean, but it seemed like it'd be a surefire hit at the time, right? You've got Paul McCartney. He's the lead. You've got Beatles songs. You know, you've got a hit single from it. What could possibly go wrong?
Famous last words.
Exactly.
I mean, could it be argued that this was just an issue of timing? Like, did Paul wait too long to start work on his grand musical? Like, if Broadstreet had come out in 77, 78, after Wings Over America, I could see this being, you know, something akin to Sound of Music or Mary Poppins or Oliver, a movie we're going to reference a lot in this episode, quite clearly, but...
Yeah, I don't know if it was that. I mean, it could be. I think part of it was, and this really came through to me as I was watching this again, that and this would have escaped me, you know, at 12 years old, that, you know, I think this was definitely a time when he was really, you know, at a time where he was trying to figure out where he fit in the contemporary landscape. I mean, you know, he in the 70s, obviously, he was still scoring a lot of hits. And maybe you're right. I mean, maybe he should have struck when the iron was hot. You know, when he was really on a roll with all of his hits with Wings and everything in the 80s, you know, he, of course, had a great hit with Tug of War. I mean, he was doing really well. But then I think, you know, he was trying to figure out where does he fit in the contemporary landscape. He teamed up with Michael Jackson, which I thought was a smart move. Very smart move. But he, I think, was trying to figure out, all right, now, you know, what is this, you know, new musical landscape? Where do I fit in? And so, you know, with Pipes of Peace, you know, he didn't do as well critically or commercially as Tug of War. So, like, you notice, and we'll get into this a bit more in a minute, but with Broadstreet, I mean, he had, you know, the scene with Silly Love Songs with the breakdancer in it. You know, he's so desperately trying to figure out how to fit in with the current sounds of the time. And
easy,
you know,
to try to rap, at least.
Yeah, exactly. God.
My name is Polly, and I'm here to say, in the USA, you know, like, could you, oh my God.
Oh,
that
my God.
That play, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that would have, oh dear. And so, yeah, at least he didn't do that. And but you, when you see the video, to which you, of course, can find on YouTube, to the playout version of No More Lonely Nights, that has tons of breakdancers in it and everything. So you can just see he is so desperately trying to be current, you know. And so I think that was part of the problem with this, that he wanted to do in the interviews, he talked about wanting to do an old-fashioned musical, but at the same time, you know, he was so desperately trying to figure out where he fit in. And, you know, it just didn't really work. So maybe if he had, as you said, you know, I think you make a good point, maybe in the 70s when he was fitting in just fine with the times, you know, where he did have his finger on the pulse of the sound then, maybe, you know, maybe it would have worked out better. But I think by the 80s he was in this period and, you know, didn't quite work.
The term vanity project is possibly never more appropriate than today. Though I'm yet to see the Bee Gees and Peter Frampton, Sgt. Pepper. So this might not be the worst thing we are yet to review on this podcast.
Oh, you haven't seen that yet?
No, because I'm not a sadomasochist, Kit.
Oh, you're in for a treat.
Also, just as a quick aside, you know when you said you bought the soundtrack, were you affected by the whole, do I buy the vinyl, the cassette, or the CD debacle?
You know, I got the vinyl, you know, when it came out, because that was pretty much all that was, available. I mean, you know, when I was a kid. And yeah, and I mean, when I found out later that, yeah, there were all the CD, you know, had all these extra tracks on it and everything, I couldn't believe it, you know. So yeah, so I mean, it was, and then I remember, you know, as a kid turning over the, you know, on the album when it said that this album is longer than the usual vinyl record and all this stuff. I mean, it was really crazy at the time. Years later, I got the CD version, but yeah, that was crazy. But yeah, back then, you know, I mean, CD players were not plentiful. I mean, you know, they were expensive. I didn't know anybody back then that had one. I mean, those were rare. So it was, yeah, that was crazy that, you know, there were all these different configurations. Of course, Paul still loves to do that stuff, to have all these different configurations.
He does that all too well, doesn't he?
I know, doesn't he? He always, he gets every single configuration, where with me, it's just like, oh, God, you know, the headache starts to spread.
Could you imagine, though, if like, the White Album came out with, oh, by the way, there's something called Not Guilty and Carnival of Light. It's not on this release, but go fuck yourself. And then, you know.
I know. It's just incredible. Yeah, because I remember, you know, having the LP and then years later saying, oh, and then there's a, you know, hearing another track, you know, Good Night Princess. I'm like, what? What are you talking about?
It does sound like a lost B-side track. It's so fitting.
Yes.
I've got to ask you a slightly dubious question here. Mm-hmm. How did you watch this film? I can't watch this film legally in this country. There's no DVD release. Do you have this on DVD?
I actually don't. I have it on, I had it on VHS, you know, what? Years.
What's a VHS kit?
It is a tape from probably I got in the 80s, 90s, early 90s, something like that. And this one, but I mean, I can't play it anymore because it's, I mean, that format is long gone. And so I actually had to watch it on YouTube.
Now, I do have to reiterate, there is not a free rip of Give My Regards to Broadstreet available for free on YouTube right now. There is not MPL. Do not investigate any further. Oddly enough, though, when I first arranged this with you, Kit, there was only the one rip, and it was split into, like, 10-minute clips.
Yes, that's what I saw. Yeah.
Two weeks ago, the full film was uploaded in one video.
No way! I didn't see that.
Anything like HD and everything. Like I had to like rub my eyes like I was a Disney character waking up or something. It was like, what? And it was there, yeah.
No kidding! Oh my gosh! No, I didn't see that. Wow. Yep, I saw the one that was, yeah, as you said, split up into all different clips.
For legal reasons, I assume.
Yes.
Right. Let's move on to our main topic of the day. After much deliberation, Kit, I thought the best way for us to approach this material would be to go through the film chronologically and address the songs as and when they come up. Because if you do the film, then the album, we're going to retread a lot of ground. But so all the different versions of the album with all the different songs. And I think the movie's the official, you know, product. And, you know, the idea of the film's bad and the soundtrack's good, that's been done to death. So let's just treat this as one package. Let's begin.
Let's do it.
So we start with some very strange.
Very good.
What is that? then like a little finger traces the title card. Did anyone besides Paul get the pun in this title?
Yeah, I don't think so. I know, but he thought it was very clever. You know, he really did. You know, it was his nod to, you know, we know he loves old musicals. You know, he loves, you know, as we know from his past compositions and well, even the James Paul McCartney special that he did all the, you know, gotta sing, gotta dance. I mean, he loves these old, you know, Broadway musical kind of references. So, you know, it's give my regards to Broadway. It's you know, his little pun on that. So, so yeah, that and he wanted this to be a throwback to old Broadway musicals. So that was his, you know, nod to that. So that's presumably what that pun was about.
Yeah, I'm a guest and some part-time host on a podcast called Pun It, which is a game show all about puns. And mm-hmm. I can tell you from the bottom of my heart, it's not funny or clever. It's just not. It's an awful pun. And folks, I don't have any technical knowledge of music ever, but I do have a film degree from one of the worst universities in the UK, so I'm going to be putting my film hat on today.
Oh, great!
And opening shots, opening images on a film are incredibly important. Just think of, like, you know, the opening scene from Gladiator, you know, the huge fight between the barbarians and the Romans, you know, or the opening scene of Saving Private Ryan, you know, these things that really leave you in awe and wonder. And what do we get? This 2 second shot of some jackhammers tearing up concrete, fading into the shot of, like, raining traffic jams. This is not edge of your seat cinema kit, is it? I mean, even the James Paul McCartney TV special with Big Barn Bed had a better opening sequence than this.
Yeah, doesn't grab you right away, does it? Doesn't really grab your interest, like, not gripping stuff.
Do you think he was trying to go for, like, a Wizard of Oz style, like, we're just in Kansas kind of opening?
That's what I was kind of wondering, too, because, yeah, that this is like the drab, everyday world, and we're about to go into a world of fantasy.
Yeah, the everyday world where you're being driven by your chauffeur in your Rolls Royce kit.
Yeah, you know, every day.
We've all, you know, sympathize with that. We've all been there, you know?
Sure.
I can't remember who the original director, Paul, something Webb, Peter Webb, was it? Something like that.
Yes, Peter Webb.
He was like, Paul, you're going to come across as a massive asshat if this is your opening scene. And yeah, he does. I mean, if this was going to be some sort of Emperor's New Clothes style story where he has to be humbled like Thor, then this would be perfect. But since we're in the middle of Thatcherite England and Reaganomics America, it seems a bit far removed from the audience's own life experiences, and we're just off to the worst start, in my opinion.
Yeah, tone deaf. Yeah.
Which is ironic for the man who almost invented tone.
Yeah, that's right.
And then we cut to the chauffeur going, oh no. Oh no. Oh no. Oh, look, I'm sure Paul thought that this was a very natural way to get in some exposition into the movie, but it is anything but. It's incredibly forced, and we meet Paul's manager, who's totally not Steve Shrimpton. At all. Paul's not having a go at his manager, who he would soon sack quite famously.
Yeah.
Great example of ego in the opening credits. I don't know if you noticed this, Kit, but when it says screenplay by Paul McCartney, it shows a shot of Paul literally doing some writing in the backseat of his car. Very subtle.
Yeah, just so we understand. Yep, absolutely.
Oh, I get it now. I understand.
Exactly. And I couldn't help but think back to, of course, the way he wrote, and I kind of use the term loosely, Magical Mystery Tour. Wasn't he supposed to have sketched that out as like a pie chart or something?
Like it all goes round, then it divides it in four. Yeah.
Now you think he would have learned from that, you know, that's not a script. And
the Mystery Tour is a circle, the Beatles are a square, the moon is Ellen 7, or, you know, I don't know what's going on in this.
Yep. Exactly.
This opening scene is really all over the place for me, Kit. And what's indicative here is the fact that this is, I didn't get this until the second time I watched it after I read a few reviews. This is a movie full of dream sequences. And the language of film, the language of filmmaking is so important. And all this film needed was a little wibble wobble, wibble wobble, wibble wobble, like as a little visual transition from the real world to the dream world. And the translation of this concept is so poorly done that I genuinely didn't know that certain things were and weren't dream sequences. I'm going to bring this up a lot. I'm not going to blame the director. You know, he was handed a big tofu turkey, just like Michael Lindsay Hogg with Let It Be. He's honestly doing the best with what he's been given. But as we know, Paul kind of wanted a yes man. And then at the end went, oh, I should have just gone to Steven Spielberg. Spielberg wouldn't have touched this movie with a 10-foot pole.
But no, that's a really good point, though, because that was true that the first time I watched this years ago, I wasn't sure when he was dreaming and when he wasn't. I mean, there were times like that where, I mean, some of it was kind of obvious, but yeah, I mean, like even some of the musical sequences, you were thinking that. I mean, obviously the Victorian sequence and all, but I mean, some of the others, you were like, is he shooting a video? Is this a dream? What is this?
I mean, genuine question, Kit. Do you think Paul believes in all the lofty, overly intellectual, Kubrickian elements involved with filmmaking, like cinematography, shot composition, symbolism, thematics, structure, pacing, hidden messages? My gut's telling me no.
No. I mean, that's the thing. I think that, and I'm not saying it's just Paul. I mean, I think, you know, there are probably many people who have made terrible movies that, I think they don't understand. And hey, that's why I don't make movies, because I mean, I'll throw myself in here. It is way more complicated than you think it is. I mean, it really is. And that's why I'm not a fiction writer. I'm a nonfiction writer. It takes a certain set of skills and a lot of things. And I think, you know, a lot of people think it's easy to shoot a movie or to write a screenplay. And it isn't. And here's Exhibit A.
So ironic that even in the film, his manager says, "You do the songs, I'll run the business." I wish someone had told Paul that during the making of this fucking movie. You know?
Yeah. I mean? Right. Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. Yep.
Sorry, folks. There's going to be a lot of heavy breathing into the mic with this.
Exactly. And again, and I'll say, you know, love Paul. I hate to bash him, because I mean, really, I love his music. I mean, I'm a fan, but you know,
you've got to pull the Band-Aid off. You've got to pull the Band-Aid off.
Yeah, this was a misstep. What can I tell you?
We then cut to Paul inside of this over-the-top greaser speed with flames painted on the side, and it's got a Knight Rider computer that tells him his schedule for the day. And great premise for a scene on paper, and yet somehow they managed to make it incredibly drab and dull. And like, if this is meant to be a dream sequence, Kit, are Paul's dreams just the most boring thing ever?
Well, and you know what? And this was throughout the entire movie. I thought he looked either bored or I mean, you're just like, okay, you're in this dream sequence, you're in this hot car, okay, you're supposed to be dreaming that you're on the open road, you're in this hot car, you're at, you know, you have this cool computer in your car, which, by the way, was sort of kind of like what we have today. I mean, it was kind of, yeah, I mean, isn't that cool? I mean, I kind of thought that was cool. Like, wow, that sort of was an omen of things to come. That was kind of neat. But anyway, but I'm like, okay, so you've got this. Why do you look so miserable?
Maybe the first song will cheer him up a little bit. At the 2-minute mark, we get "Good Day Sunshine." And it comes on the radio diegetically, which I thought was a pretty nice touch.
Yes.
It's meant to represent the literal sunshine in the scene around him. I do get that. I'm not sure it's the best song to start the film off. Kit, I'm going to be honest. I'm going to ask this same question pretty much every time we come across a song that's already been remade. But what are your thoughts on the original? What do you think of the remake?
Well, of course. I mean, it's you know, love the song. I mean, what can I tell you? It's, you know, I was amazed at how, I mean, he almost, I mean, copied it note for note. I mean, it you know, really is almost identical to the original. A really little difference. I mean, it was one of those moments, though, where I kind of thought, why, you know, in a way, why did he, you know, why did he do that? I mean, why did he bother remaking it if he was just going to do it note for note for note? I mean, it was fine. I just kind of think I would, you know, I think I would stick with the original. I prefer it. I don't know. I just thought this was kind of an unnecessary remake in a way. But it was fine. But I just thought, I don't know. I just thought the original maybe had a little more energy to it. But I mean, it just sounded, as I said, almost identical. So for that reason, I kind of thought, why do it then? But you know, it was a good remake. But just sort of, I thought, kind of pointless in a way. So I don't know. What do you think?
Okay.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, you know, Paul's remaking all these Beatles songs. Is he going to do something really interesting, like add a whole 5-minute instrumental scene to the
end? Exactly.
No, he's just doing it the same, but with an 80s production, which... Look, he wasn't to know, but man, that Jeff Emmerich 60s production has aged so well.
Mm-hmm.
And his voice was better in 66.
Yeah.
Why is there so much Revolver on this album, Kit? Why is there no Abbey Road or Rubber Soul? What's going on?
Yeah, that's interesting. I wonder why he was so heavy. I mean, hey, Revolver's a wonderful album. It's probably my favorite Beatles album. But yeah, you'd think that if he wanted to revisit, you know, his Beatles past, yeah, why didn't he choose from all different Beatles albums? That's a good point. I don't know. But yeah, I just thought, I mean, as I said, it's not a bad remake. But yeah, why just repeat it almost note for note and not add anything new to it? It just seemed kind of pointless.
There are so many songs I would have loved to have heard him redo, like a more modern version of Michelle or Fixing Up.
Right.
Maybe he's trying to distance himself from the Pepper movie. Who knows?
Yep.
I mean, this is still before Revolver had its second legs, you know, and was kind of regarded. Maybe Paul was actually ahead of the curve on this one.
Yeah, maybe.
Then we move on to the dramatic incident, the inciting incident for all you film buffs out there. The tapes are missing, Kit! The tapes are missing! And how does Paul react, Kit? How does Paul react to this revelation?
Wow. He said...
It's like his newspaper's been misplaced, isn't it?
He doesn't seem all that bothered by it. And you know... And I remember when I was watching this again, I thought, because when I first saw this years ago, I was like... Okay, you know, I mean, yes, that's certainly distressing that the tapes are missing, but why does that mean that his record company is then going to be taken over by these, like, shady... Like, why does that mean that his company will be taken over by these creepy-looking people? You know, I mean, like, and watching it again, I'm like, yeah, I still don't get it. Like, what? How does that, you know... So, here we go, plot hole number one.
Are you telling me... Okay, A, what business transaction would draft up a contract that would allow these terms to take place?
Right.
Who would sign such a contract? And are you also telling me that Lee Eastman... wouldn't sue the shit out of Rathbone? Come on. And also, why can't they delay the album? Paul cancelled a whole Japanese tour twice.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, yeah, this made no sense the first time I saw it. Makes no sense now. I mean, it's just, yeah, and that one guy, that really creepy-looking guy, I forget his, I can't remember the actor's name. Yeah, woo. I mean... You know, so you know,
cigarette holders and brandy glasses and sunglasses. You know, he plays the part of the ridiculous villain perfectly.
Yeah, exactly. So you're just like, I don't know who the, you know, why this guy is so, I mean, he looks evil. So, I mean, you know, he means business, but you just think, what exactly is he going to do? And so, I mean, it just absolutely makes no sense whatsoever.
I kind of thought, like, maybe it'd be, like, Rathbone was behind the theft of the tapes, and that would make his presence in the movie not completely pointless.
Yeah.
But no, he's not involved in the theft of the tapes.
Nope.
And, you know, okay, maybe they can make him do, like, an Alan Klein or something. No, they don't do that either. It's going to be the start of a long list of would've, should've, could've.
Yeah, but shout out to Brian Brown, you know, I mean, poor guy, he was, you know, he's just kind of stuck having to look worried in the movie and all, because I like Brian Brown. I mean, he's a good actor, but, you know, poor guy. I mean, you know, he's just sort of stuck with this part, and but, you know, poor guy.
Of course, the villains in a Paul McCartney story are the men in suits. How original. I mean, what's next, Paul? Themes of freedom.
but yeah, that just, yeah, this is just right off the bat, gigantic plot hole.
Yeah, it just, I mean, even the premise of the whole missing tapes being important is so arrogantly self-serving. Like, actually, Paul, they won't give a shit if these tapes don't get released. I mean, you're not exactly doing well in the 80s. I mean, again, wouldn't it have been great if it was about him being unpopular and struggling to find his way in the modern pop music scene, and then he has this triumphant comeback at the end? But no, he's not going to risk his self-serving public image like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, and the tapes are so important at various points in the movie, they glow.
Yes. Are you telling me Quentin Tarantino was not influenced by that when he made Pulp Fiction and the...
Oh, clearly.
I never thought I'd mention Pulp Fiction on this podcast, but I'm so glad I finally have.
I never thought you'd mention Pulp Fiction and Broadstreet in the, like, the same context, so that's shocking enough for me.
Well, I mean, this is clearly taking place in some sort of 1980s where Paul McCartney's still a massive deal. You know, maybe this is in the alternative reality 80s that Joaquin Phoenix's Joker film took place in, but even that 1980s was a little more believable than this.
Yeah, right, exactly.
You know, hey, Paul, do you know what you get? You get what you fucking deserve, you know?
Yeah, right.
I can't believe that there weren't more puns on this being a day in the life of Paul McCartney. Like, that was the real pun.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and as I recall, the ads, like, actually try to, you know, to advertise this as a day in the life of a rock star. And, yeah. Mm-hmm. And,
kind of coke or hookers, Kit, if I'm honest.
Yeah. Yeah, you just think in some ways, like, wow, if this is a day in the life of a rock star, this is pretty boring.
I do not want to be a rock star, yeah.
Yeah.
I'd rather drink a rock star.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Then we go to the studio where Paul's going to record some more songs with Ringo. Again, why are they recording new songs if the album's already completed? Is this like, yep, a protracted tug of war pipes of peace session? Is this a new album? Or just another plot hole, Kit?
Yeah, well, I thought that too. It's just like, wait a minute, I thought the tapes were all gone. So what is this for? Yeah, that's it. It's exactly. And as I was preparing for this and I was, you know, looking over various notes, I love, there was some reviewer who said, now you would think, okay, Paul and Ringo are together again. Well, isn't, you know, aren't they thrilled to see each other? Isn't this going to be fun? No, they're just kind of like, hey, tapes are missing. Oh, and that means we have to do it over again. Oh, that's it. I mean, you know,
was it a genuine novelty to see these two together? They'd already reunited for Take It Away a couple of years prior.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, that, yeah, so it's not like they're reunited after this long period of time. But, I mean, you know, you just think, like, wouldn't this, isn't this supposed to be fun to see them on screen together, working together? And they just make it so dreary.
I don't know what it is. I mean, I can hear Ken Michael shouting, Sam, you're thinking about this too much, but I'm going to fight back with tooth and nail here.
Yeah, because, I mean, you just think they should have more chemistry than this.
Well, I mean, Ringo is clearly, after 2 seconds, the more natural actor than Paul will ever be.
Oh, sure. Absolutely.
It's also great to see George Martin. I mean, he appears more in this than he does in, like, the Let It Be documentary. He actually has a line of dialogue.
Yep. Yep, and at least he seems pretty natural in it. I mean, he's just himself, of course, but, you know, he seems less self-conscious.
It would have been great if he said, gentlemen, you've just recorded your first number 12. His lack of presence in this movie is so in your face. Yeah, everyone back. Maybe they can do the jam song from the Let It Be sessions, you know. around the 12-minute mark, we get the medley, because of course there's got to be a fucking medley of Yesterday, Here, There, and Everywhere, and Wanderlust. Why is Wanderlust in a medley with these two classic Beatles songs? Is Paul trying to tell us that his post-Beatle work matches up to Yesterday and Here, There, and Everywhere? Or is it just for musical reasons, do you think?
You know, that's an interesting question, because it is odd to throw Wanderlust in with those two songs. I will say, though, I kind of liked it. I didn't like this version of Yesterday as well as the original. I don't know. I mean, it's, you know, I don't know. I just thought this version just sounded a little, trying to think of how to describe it, a little flatter to me. I mean, not off tune, but I mean, just, not as, I don't know, just not as spirited perhaps as the original, but I don't know. I will say that, Wanderlust did kind of fit in, strangely enough. And I will say, I love that song. I do love Wanderlust. So I will admit that, it's, you know, I'm a little prejudiced, I guess. So I actually like this version a little more than the tug of war version. I like the string arrangement better and some of the horns too. So I will say that. So I'm, you know, a little prejudiced. But I know what you're saying. It's interesting that he would throw that in, you know, kind of as if he's, you know, saying this is just as good as the other. So I mean, it's, you know, I can see that could seem kind of, I don't know, like he's trying to argue, well, my solo stuff is just as good and should be equated with my Beatles work. But I don't know. It worked for me.
He could have done, like, Yesterday, Here, There, and Everywhere, and then bit bop.
Yeah. If he had done that, I would have said, okay, Paul, you know, stop smoking that stuff. But Here, There, and Everywhere, I thought that did kind of flow into Wanderlust fairly well. So that actually didn't bother me as much as I thought it would. But yes, if he had done something else, yeah, bip-bop or something, that would have really bothered me. But Wanderlust, I don't know. That really didn't bother me. I thought that worked fairly well.
Kit, there is an acoustic song on Tug of War that would have been very appropriate, and it's called Here Today.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I think that would have solicited more tears lockdown, he would have been able to mop up in the cinemas. Like, that would have been perfect for me, but there's not an opportunity for Ringo to do drums, and I get that.
Yeah.
Very funny to see him looking for his brushes and, you know.
Oh yeah, that didn't work for me. I thought that was kind of like a silly little, like, particularly during those songs, I thought that was kind of an unnecessary distraction. And I just, you know, like, oh, let's throw in a little comedy thing for Ringo. I mean, I just thought during those songs, I just thought that was weird. But, you know, like, throw in some other comedy thing for Ringo later, you know. I thought that was just like a really odd time to throw that in. I thought that was very, you know, very weird. But just one of so many weird moments. Yeah. Just one of many.
Yeah. I mean, there's so much underappreciated wordplay in this film than I probably would have ever have guessed. I mean, it's not exactly a Spaniard in the works or anything.
No.
But the reliance on slapstick is cringy. Like, when, like, that guy's getting out the car before the interview at the end, like, he just drops a bunch of paperwork. He's like, you know, here we go.
Well, and did you, you know, Sam, I noticed, like, and I didn't pick up on this years ago because I was, you know, not as into the Beatles as I, you know, or didn't study them as closely as later on. But I feel like Paul must have watched Hard Day's Night and Help and saw, like, some of the, you know, witty repartee and some of that stuff and like with Norman Shake and all that, and thought, okay, I'm gonna try to put some of that in, you know. I mean, I saw some of that, and I mean, obviously didn't work nearly as well, but, you know, with some of the like, you know, other periphery characters, like, you know, like the roadie and stuff like that. And I just remember watching that thinking, oh man, you know, he tried.
He definitely watched Help and took away all the wrong lessons.
Exactly.
In the way that, like, a lot of young white men watch American History X and take the wrong messages away from that film, you know.
Yeah, right.
I mean, just to summarize my thoughts on the songs, Wings Over America, let's just curry nostalgia with Yesterday. Lennon loved Here, There and Everywhere. Of course he was going to include that song. Why does he change the opening line though, Kit? Why does he fuck with me? I need a better life. I need a love of my own.
Yeah.
Not working as well.
Yeah, that was really weird. I'm glad you brought that up because, yes, that has bothered me ever since this came out. Yeah, why did he change that line?
And yet he won't change the title of Frozen Japanese. I'm not even going to call it.
I
had a bit of fan mail from a guy named Douglas Chen. Shout out to Douglas. And he's a Korean listener, and he was just telling me about how that title has been the bane of his existence his whole life. And I've pretty much done a complete 180. I think I was a bit of a white British clone just going, oh, you know, I don't think anyone minds being called that word. And I'm like, oh, Paul, that's probably the lowest point of your career, really.
Especially, yeah.
Do things like Atlantic Ocean and P.S. and Return to Pepperland, where he would talk about civil rights and stuff like that. And
yeah.
Bit further east, you know, he didn't seem to extend the same kind of care.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, so it's, yep, really, really
is what it is.
Exactly.
Then we finally meet Harry in another flashback, which, correct me if I'm wrong, Kit, is either a flashback in a dream sequence or a dream within a dream. Like, is this Chris Nolan's Inception we're watching here? We've got to go deeper.
Yeah. Okay, now I'm going to echo Ken. You're overthinking this.
I'm expecting Tom Hardy to show up and I'm going to go, don't be afraid to dream a little bigger, darling. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, if Leo DiCaprio could come in and just shoot Harry, that would end this film nice and quickly for him.
But yeah, exactly. That's yet another. Yeah, it gets confusing at times. Yeah, exactly. Is this a dream? What is this?
Okay, as we all know, the rule of filmmaking is Tell, Don't Show. oh, no, wait, it's Show, Don't Tell.
Well,
and
tell.
Unfortunately, Paul just tells us, Paul and Harry are friends, just accept it and move on. You know, it's not natural at all. But Harry does say he's not such a bad boy. Is that meant to inspire Paul within the movie to write that song later? Because Bad Boy is one of the dream songs. Like, again, yeah, I'm thinking too much. I'm
gonna move on. No, I thought the same thing. When I watched this again, I suddenly didn't. Well, first time around, I didn't catch that. And when I saw it again, I'm like, wait a minute. Did that inspire him to write that song? What is that?
Then, Kit, we move on to the scene of the old bloke asking for an autograph, and he says he doesn't like Paul's music. And I was, okay, this could be a good scene if they didn't have a stuffy old fart deliver the line.
Yeah.
Saying, oh, you know, only uncool gits don't like my stuff, you know. When, in actuality, it should have been a young punk or a new wave, you know, even Tracy Ullman type character who is asking for a signature for their mum. That would be funnier, and it would be a reversal of the young girls chasing him into a car from A Hard Day's Night. I'm a fucking genius. Like, I'm going to keep coming at you with these suggestions left and right.
No, that should have been a lot funnier.
There's one of my favourite quotes is Fran Marsh talking about the Lord of the Rings screenwriting process. She's Peter Jackson's wife.
Mm-hmm.
And she just says she likes to take a red pen to certain scenes from the book. And I'd love to take a red pen to this script. Just
I agree. I mean, that scene could have been a lot funnier. I mean, because the line was funny. It just was, wrong person to deliver it.
Next up, we got a scene with Paul arguing with his manager, and it is laughably bad, Kit. I mean, Paul's acting in Pirates of the Caribbean 5 was better.
that was just a ridiculous argument. And then apparently they kiss and make up by singing Zippity Doodah. What?
Another incredibly problematic a reference in this episode from Song of the South. Every Alabama native's favorite Disney film, obviously. I don't think you can even, it's probably easier to find a copy of Song of the South though than it is to find a copy of My Regards to Broadstreet.
They're supposedly, you know, screaming at each other, not exactly, but I mean just over whatever, and I mean just making no sense, and then all of a sudden, you know, it's time for Paul to leave, and then they start singing Zippity Doodah. I mean, what? I mean, it just makes no sense.
Like, they reference having a bluebird on your shoulder. I was like, oh, is that a Band on the Run reference? But like, no, it's just the reference to Zippity Doodah.
Right. I mean, it's just, there's just no point to the scene. The argument goes nowhere. I mean, it doesn't move the story along. Ridiculous.
You know, the conflict between him and his manager in another film, that would come to a head at the end of the second act. And they'd split up like a romantic comedy, and then they'd realize they love each other, and they'd get back for the third act to find Harry. This is a script written by a man who, according to Denny Lane, smoked 2 pounds of pot a day. So, I can't judge too much. But we do move on to possibly my favourite sequence in the movie. Not the song, just the little 30 seconds of preparing for the ballroom dancing sequence. Because, Kit, I love films filmed within films. Within dreams. But I love films that show the filmmaking process. And just cutting to Paul, showing the kids a run-through of the song, I was charmed. I was charmed so much. Dun, 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 dun. And they're all leaning over. They're setting up the cameras. All the dancers are practicing their moves. Love it.
Yeah.
Then Barbara Bach shows up, Kit.
this made you know, this made no sense. I mean, well, obviously they were trying to, you know, set up a little love interest for Ringo. And, you know, and I forget what she said. I mean, it was just hysterical. At first I thought she was just going to be a reporter, you know, but no, she was like supposed to be writing some, like, it sounded like a dissertation, which I thought was pretty funny. As someone who's written one, you know, I'm like, yeah, she would totally be there. I mean, it just cracked me up. And you know, and Ringo sort of, you know, of course, hitting on her and everything. I mean, it, you know, it was just ridiculous. I mean, I was really laughing, and I think that might be one of her few lines in the whole movie, because I think the rest of the movie she just sits in the background nodding her head to the music. I think that's about it.
This movie does not pass the Bechdel test at all. Jesus Christ.
I know. I mean, it's just God.
It's a movie produced by Harvey Weinstein, and we've got Ringo essentially being a very problematic creeper. Whenever Bob, I get it. It's his real life wife. It's an in joke, but he's sexually harassing her and trying to get her to have sex with him to hear a copy of the album. It's not flying in 2020, Kit. It's not flying.
I know. I mean, practically, you know, she introduces herself and wants to interview him, and he's immediately like, "Oh, why don't you come back to my room?" You know. I mean, you know. Like, whoa, fast there, Ringo.
He's acting like a caveman, quite ironically.
Ah, see what you did there. Yeah,
Right, let's get on to arguably the most fun part. 25 minutes after we get ballroom dancing. Kit, this is my favorite song off Tug of War. I'm just going to say it.
Yep, I love it too. That I love the song. I love the song, and I actually like this remake. It's another one that I wouldn't say was entirely necessary, but I actually do like this remake. Almost, I'm trying to decide if I like it more than the Tug of War version, but I do like the extended instrumental break in it.
As well.
Oh, I'm sorry?
There's an extra verse as well.
Yeah, the extra verse. I actually do like this version. I really have. Sometimes I've actually played this more than the Tug of War version. So I do like it. The sequence itself, it's another one that I think could have been better. It had promise. I think part of it, I don't know, I think it goes on a little too long. Maybe that's part of it. I kind of like the idea of having, you know, the ballroom dancing and then the naughty rock and roll kids coming in.
Yeah.
I mean, it could have been fun. I mean, you know, silly, but it could have been fun. I don't know. I just think the execution wasn't great. I just think I can defer to you on some of this, since you're a film, you know, you're a film student. I don't know if it was the cinematography. I don't know. I thought of the execution was a little amateurish to me. I don't know. You know, you'll probably have more to say about this than I do, but it just felt like it could have been better. You know, it should have been better. Because you had a great song to work with on this and a great version, and it just seems like it should have been more entertaining than it was. I don't know. What do you think?
Kit, just as an aside, how are you doing for time? I'm not.
Oh, I'm fine. No, I'm good.
So, Kit, this for me, like, just going back to the song, I've got to say, the fact that they keep the "That's it, kids" and "Wave the sword," the fact they kept that on the final soundtrack makes me so happy. I love that. I love the idea of, okay, dreams within dreams. Is this reality? Is this fiction? this is one of the key scenes where, like, this, you know, this reveals how someone is approaching this movie, because it starts off quite clearly in reality. Paul is the director, but then he's also the lead singer who gets up on stage. Like, he gets off the camera and then gets on the big revolving stage, and then you've got the ballroom dancers themselves coming in. But then, like, they're clearly part of the music video at first, but then the greasers come on and it descends into this big brawl, and then they end up mobbing the stage. And yeah. It's the first time in the film where I thought, this doesn't make any sense, and I love it. It's utterly glorious in its chaos. I mean, it's a clear example of someone not telling Paul no. Like, Paul, do you want to do Gotta Sing, Gotta Dance Part 2, or do you want to do Grease is the Word? Well, why not both? No, Paul, you can't do both. You've got to pick one and do it right. You know, like, what if Spielberg said, right, I want to do a movie about dinosaurs and the Holocaust. No, Spielberg, you've got to do two separate things. They're two different ideas. They don't work together. Maybe a little too extreme of an example, but it's all over the place. But
yep.
The best part, Kit, for me, as someone who loves a bit of schadenfreude, how expensive is this scene? Oh my!
Yeah,
I just want to. You know those machines you see where people are tallying up their taxes in like classic 90s American things, where it's like a one-armed bandit, like, and that ticket's coming out, and they've got a green visor hat on and stuff. I'm like, how much is this totting up? What are Paul's finances thinking at this time? Like,
I
said earlier, did they recoup the cost from this scene?
No kidding. And I should add, I love at the end when Linda punches out one of the dancers on scene, on the stage, I should say. That's great.
Great in this whole film. I think, she looks fucking fabulous throughout it.
Yep.
I've got a thing for a bit of androgyny and short hair, and she looks great dressed as a bloke on stage here, I must admit. It titillates me in a way that probably my late father liked at all. As a little aside here, correct me if I'm wrong, it's actually pretty unique that all the songs featured in this film are in the same order as the track listing on the soundtrack.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And you know, quite frankly, I hadn't thought about that for a while. And then, yeah, when I was looking at the running, I'm like, oh, yeah, that's right. They're all in this exact same order, which is kind of unusual for a soundtrack. Yeah.
It's fun. I mean, it's almost like, you know, you can read the book along with the film, and you can look at the album, and, like, you know what's coming next, especially once he plays For No One and there's a string quartet in the background, like, I know what's coming next, you know.
Exactly.
Then, as Linda says, let's break for lunch.
And yep.
I'm sure Paul thought all the hilarious cameos and Star Wars references were, you know, they were oh so fun. They're not. It's like Doctor Who level cringe, you know.
Yep.
I know there are a lot of Doctor Who fans who listen to this show, because there's a weird Venn diagram of Paul McCartney fans and Doctor Who fans for some reason. I've never understood that. We even get a little Mary Poppins reference as well. There's a lot of Mary Poppins references in this film, actually.
Mm-hmm.
We get some more cringe between Ringo and Barbara back.
Oh.
And only possible because it's his real life wife.
Mm-hmm.
Then, Kit, we're introduced to an actress who I thought was Cyndi Lauper at first, if I'm completely honest. and I had to check the credits, and they said Tracy Ullman. And as a Brit, I was like, hang on, where have I heard The Simpsons? Tracy Ullman is in Give My Regards to Broadstreet. What the hell is going on? And yet, it's the same woman, if I'm correct.
Poor Tracy Ullman, I'll tell you. I mean, I found out, of course, years later, and I couldn't believe it. Yeah, Tracy Ullman, I mean, she is such a talented, talented person. I mean, she, you know, just one of those people that almost has, like, too much talent, you know. I mean, that she's kind of has been hard, you know, it's been hard for her to really become a major, major, major sister star, because, you know, she's one of those people that can play almost any part, can take on almost any role to the point where she's like a chameleon, you know. And so she's never been able to really be a major, major star because she's like unrecognizable when she takes on different roles, you know. And, you know, she's a comedian, she's a singer. And in fact, the same year that she did Broadstreet, she actually had a hit single called They Don't Know, which is sounds like it was sort of a throwback to a girl group. And Paul appeared in her video. Yep.
It's not what you know, Kit. It's not what you know. It's who you know.
Yep, exactly. And, you know, and I remember watching that video when I was a kid and, you know, and not really making the connection, you know, yet. And I, of course, didn't realize that probably Paul was in the video as kind of a thank you, you know, for her appearing in his movie. And so, you know, so, yeah, so that was it. And that was her only top 10 hit. It was a top 10 in America. And I assume it was in Britain, too. I'm not sure. And then she went on to have her own show, Tracy Ullman Show. And as you said, The Simpsons debuted on it. And unfortunately, her show didn't last as long. And The Simpsons went on to become a big hit. But she went on to appear in movies and in TV. So, yeah, this was an early role for her. And poor Tracy. Paul gave her nothing to do. She
cries and she cries. She sobs. She's got earrings. Nice clean earrings.
I mean, that's the thing. I mean, when you watch this now, like, Paul, you had Tracy Ullman. She's hysterical. She's, as I said, she's a singer. She's a dancer. She's a comedian. And you just have her cry. I mean, what were you thinking?
Worse, Kit. So, in terms of the logic of the story, this should be a potential lead for Paul here. Oh, it's Harry's girlfriend. Okay, maybe there's going to be some drama or tension here. Maybe he's annoyed or a bit inquisitive or concerned. Maybe he thinks she's lying. No. No. Have you seen Harry? No. Okay, then. In a bit. No worries.
Yeah, that really, like, that almost makes me angriest of all in this movie, that he had Tracy Ullman and did nothing with her. I mean, that was just, yeah, that's incredible. But yeah, so she, you know, they come back to her occasionally crying and yeah.
Next, we move on to a scene that I didn't know whether it was a dream or reality again. At the 36-minute mark, we get Silly Love Songs. Kit, I detest the production on this one. The main selling point of the original is that flawless 1970s McCartney production. And here they turn this annoyingly crisp, dry, and lifeless rendition of the song. Also, if you get a good Linda McCartney vocal, do not risk it by recording another one. What are you doing?
Okay, now I have to defend one aspect of this re-recording, though, which is the bass player in this, who has that slap bass solo toward the end. That is Lewis Johnson. And I actually write about him in my other book, and okay, cheap plug is coming, which is my book, Michael Jackson FAQ, All That's Left to Know About the King of Pop. I actually write about this gentleman in my book. Lewis Johnson was like one of the top, and by the way, on many of these songs that Paul re-recorded for Broadstreet, I mean, boy, he recruited the top session musicians of the day. I mean, the top players. I mean, you know, Steve Lukather, Jeff Porcaro. I mean, the list goes on and on. Lewis Johnson was one of these guys. And he was known for being part of the Brothers Johnson. They had a hit back in the, I guess, like 80, 81, something around there called Stomp. But he was also known as...
Everybody take it to the top, we're gonna stomp.
Yes, That's it.
That's him. Oh, my God.
That's him.
I love that song. That's great.
Yep, that's right. Well, he, in addition to that, he was also, as I said, one of the top bass players of the day and is still considered one of, like, the best slap bass players ever. And he played extensively on two of Michael's albums, Off the Wall and Thriller. He played the bass line on Billie Jean. You know, he is just, he was incredible. He died 5 years ago, unfortunately. Well, that solo, and you see him playing it, you wouldn't know it because of a hideous makeup they're all wearing in that scene. But that's him playing that cool bass solo in that. So I'll defend him. He's great. And that, I like that solo. but otherwise that scene, I think that scene is creepy as hell.
Like, is it just me, or is it a production of Andrew Lloyd Webber's Cats?
Yes. I mean, what were they thinking?
A jellical paw for a jellical ball, you know? Oh,
I mean, I think Steve Lukather, who, by the way, wrote my introduction to Michael Jackson FAQ. He wrote the introduction to it. So he's a great guy, too. So, but anyway, yeah. Can you imagine how all of them must have felt having to wear that hideous makeup in that scene? Good God.
Oh, I mean, production still photo for the back of the album as well, so there's no escaping it.
Yeah, exactly. So they had to wear these hideous, and then the break dancer and the moonwalker.
Right. Let me address this, right? So we've got a group of the whitest people on film ever, right?
Yeah.
And then we have an African American dancer all dressed in black.
Mm-hmm.
Doing a facsimile of, like, I don't mean to be offensive here, but it really reminded me of, like, a black and white minstrel show. I know he didn't intend to, but anyone who's seen
a
solo video for Ebony and Ivory, which has the exact same premise, which is Paul at the piano with an African-American dancer. And again, 2020, I'm not saying it's offensive, it's just a little problematic.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, it's so awkward. I mean, and again, as I mentioned earlier, it's Paul trying to be contemporary and hip and relevant, and it doesn't work. I mean, it just, to say the least. I mean, it's just so awkward, and it's, you know, and it just ruins a great song. You know, he didn't need it. You know, I mean, why didn't he just have the band performing it, you know, normally? I mean, it's, you know, you got the great horn section. And again, I mean, you know, great band, as I said, top players of the day. Why didn't he just have them do it, you know, normally, regular performance video? That would have been fine. But no.
I think the breakdance was meant to be Michael Jackson in an early draft.
I mean, who knows? Well, the moonwalking part, I just thought, okay, you know, this was 1984, height of Michael Jackson mania. I mean, you know, this was clearly a nod to, you know, I mean, maybe not him exactly, like, you know, specifically, but certainly that period. And, you know, so I think it definitely was trying to, you know, kind of a nod to his young, you know, to his fans, younger people in general. And I was like, oh, I mean,
can we get Tito or LaToya instead, you know?
Yeah, right. I mean, it was just so cringy. And that part where, and it's actually during Louis Johnson's bass solo, which makes it even worse, that. I mean, it's just even worse when he does that. That guy the dancer starts going woo, and then does that weird, like, flip where they even have a little sound effect, and his shoes sort of turn like a, you know, start glowing and everything.
It is the worst sound effect in a Paul McCartney project since the Kiss sound in "Listen to What the Man Said."
I mean, it's just the whole thing. I mean, I think they thought that was cool, and it so isn't. It just comes off. I mean, I'm sorry, listeners. I love Paul. We all love Paul, but that was just pathetic. I mean, it's just a pathetic attempt to be cool and contemporary and hip, and it was just the opposite.
We get another shot of Tracy Ullman crying after this.
Poor Tracy.
Then we run into a scene from an actual film. which is the scene of Harry running with the tapes in hand. It's a dream within a dream, in a dream, but, you know, it's actually got a little bit of tension in it. But, of course, tension in this film is only fleeting, and it ends after about 10 seconds or something like that. I kind of wish that this may have been the opening scene, and I feel like it might have been shot that way, and then it was moved around in the edits, because... I mean, there are so many scenes we should have had at the start. A scene to establish Paul and Harry as friends at the start. A scene of Harry stealing the tapes would have been nice. I mean, in any other film. I don't ask for much, Kit. I really don't. I just want logical progression in my narrative. Maybe we've moved to the warehouse, which I actually quite have a little bit of affection for this set. It's a part of dirty old London that really doesn't exist anymore. Rather like Broadstreet Station itself, actually. And those tall, dark buildings with the kind of terrifying alleyways is a distinct Mary Poppins slash Oliver vibe.
Mm.
Kit, just as a little aside, what's your favourite musical?
Oh, my favourite musical, probably, movie musical, Singing in the Rain.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah.
Yes. Yep. Perfect.
What's that line where she's trying to get rid of her New York accent? I can't remember now. It's bugging me. You know, she's like, I can't stand him. That one.
Oh, man. Yep. I love that. I love that. I can't remember her name now. It was Lena, I think. She's hilarious.
Anyone who says Gene Kelly's the best male dancer in that movie can sod right off as well.
Oh,
the guy who sings Make Him Laugh, he's Jesus
Christ. Donald O'Connor. That Make Him Laugh scene, I mean, incredible.
Dignity, Kit. Always dignity.
That's right.
We're in the Dockside Warehouse, and at the 48-minute mark, we get Not Such a Bad Boy. This is our first original song. Kit, how does the song compare to the rest of the soundtrack for you?
Well, I mean, it's not my all-time favorite Paul song, for sure. But I find this song gets stuck in my head. I really think it's catchy in its own way. It's got a catchy chorus. I also like that it's definitely harder rocking than what we've heard, for the first time, shows a little, maybe a little life. Certainly when he plays the song in the movie, he seems to have a little more energy, and certainly with the band, he does. I mean, I think in a way he sounds more contemporary doing this, this sounds even, I don't know if, you know, this might overstate a bit, but particularly the opening chords, I mean, even sound a little new wave punkish in a way. But then as the song progresses, it's more of just a straightforward rocker. But in other words, you know, this is the first time that he's sounded in any way contemporary to me. I mean, you know, forget the breakdancing and all that stuff. I mean, this is finally a time where he sounds like he's doing something, you know, that sounds like it's of the time. I think it's as I said, doesn't rank among my all-time favorite McCartney songs, but it's got, as I said, I like the chorus kind of sticks in your head. It's got a good kind of rockin' McCartney vocal, you know, it's got that raspiness to it. This is really the only original song from the soundtrack that I like, that I think is kind of, you know, as I said, it's fun. It's fun, but I wouldn't rank him among his best. But definitely, you know, finally some energy here.
I've actually cheated. I've brought two.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, you need that many to get through this movie.
whenever I talk to someone from the colonies, as I call it, you know, I just get a a yearning to get some alcohol in me. It just reminds me of losing all that land that was once.
I understand.
It's our job to kill indigenous peoples, not
That's right.
That's not making the final fucking edit, I'll tell you that.
I was going to say, I wouldn't leave that in.
I mean, I could make a reference to Ghislaine Maxwell being arrested today by the FBI, but I won't, you know.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I think that's a long time coming. Thank God.
No, he clearly committed suicide in jail, Kit. He clearly did. There's nothing.
Yes.
I mean, just the fact that he was... I mean, Kit, you know the giant bloke in Give My Regards to Broadstreet? That was pretty much Jeffrey Epstein's prison mate. Yeah. That giant man, yeah.
Yeah, really? Yep, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, when he saw that was going to be his roommate, I think that was it.
He was a bad boy.
Yes, he was.
No more. Yes.
Oh, you crack me up.
The best thing a guest on my show can do is laugh at my jokes.
Yep.
I will cut into my review of Not Such a Bad Boy now. 3, 2. Honestly, Kit, I think this is a complete throwaway, but in the good kind. This is one of my favourite kind of McCartney throwaways, where it gets you from point A to point B, and you've got a smile at the end of it. I really wish we kind of got more of this in a full studio album. I mean, you know, we kind of get that heavier sound in the original sessions or press to play before... you know, Padgham came and did his work, and I'm glad that we don't get an overly glossy, shiny track that goes a bit too close to the middle of the road. But usually as well, Paul and the gang and their whole wardrobe, Linda's trilby, they all look great. Paul in a leather jacket, it's always a win. It's always a win.
Absolutely. And I think that's a great way you phrase it, the, you know, throwaway track. Yeah, it's just fun. You know, it's not, as I said, don't rank it among his best, but it's just, you know, as I said, just a great rocker. You know, it's not going to rank among his top 10, but it's just a fun track.
From one song with bad in the title to the next, at the 51-minute mark, we get So Bad. This is a great song. It is cheesy, it is saccharine, it is sentimental, it is lovey-dovey to the max, and I love it. It is so fun to sing along with my tone-deaf falsetto voice. There is a pain inside my heart. I can't help but sing along to it. I don't know what it is, but I kind of think this might be slightly better than the original Pubs Piece original. The vocals a little more delicate, tuned this time around. And it breaks my heart that it didn't make it onto the soundtrack and little 12-year-old Kit didn't get to hear this in her formative year.
No, I didn't get to hear this version on the album. I didn't, but I'm afraid I'm going to have to disagree with you that I like the Pipes of Peace version better. I've always loved this song. But first of all, I'll agree with you on that. I love this song. I have been a defender of this track. This is one of the songs that, you know, when we talked earlier about how much, you know, I've defended Pipes of Peace and from the first moment I heard this song, I've always loved it. And, you know, I agree. I just think the harmonies are beautiful. As you said, it's just a sweet love song. Sure, it might be cheesy and over sentimental. So what? It's just a great classic McCartney pop song. And as he sings, what's wrong with that? And I just I've always loved it. I don't know. I guess there's just something about, I like his vocal a little better. On the Pipes of Peace version, I don't know what it is, but I, on the other hand, I'm really glad though that he redid the song on Broadstreet, in that it brought more attention to this track, because I've always thought, you know, it deserved more attention than it got. And I remember, you know, when this song came out as a single, back when I was a kid, and the video, which I still think is charming, by the way, it's, you know, of course you can see it on YouTube or any, and you know, I've always loved the video to it too. So while I prefer the Pipes of Peace version, I'm glad he brought it back for Broadstreet, because it got the song even more attention. So I'm really glad to hear you like the song too, because as I said, a lot of people just thought it was, oh, it was just fluff, and you know, I love it.
You've just mentioned what's wrong with that. Like, some people automatically assume that Paul has no metatextual self-awareness to him. Maybe he was very fully aware that he was writing something in the vein of Silly Love Songs, but not, because like Silly Love Songs is a protest song in a way, you know, hey, I'll write whatever the hell I want to, and So Bad is just, I write love songs, love, love songs about love, you know, and great, come on, like anyone who doesn't love Paul at the hot, you know, at the extreme, you know, we've just had him at his most rocky that he can summon, and now we're at him at his softest. That's a nice little contrast.
Exactly.
Then, Kit, we have to talk about the song that hits us at the 54-minute mark, which is No Values, our second original track. Please tell me, Kit, that you have enough values to write off No Values.
Yeah, No Values just has never done it for me. It's okay. I don't hate it, but I don't know. I just never stuck with me. Because as I said, Not Such a Bad Boy, at least that has a catchiness to it that stays with you. And just yelling No Values. I mean, I don't know. It just has never really resonated with me. And I mean, it's fine. I don't hate it, but it's just not to me a very memorable track. It's fun in the movie to see Paul and the band kind of jamming on it. I mean, that's fine. But other than that, I just think, you know, that could have been let's just put it this way, they could have left that off the soundtrack and I would have been okay with that. Let's put it that way.
So Bad should have been on the soundtrack. And
Yeah, I would have been fine with that on the soundtrack rather than No Values.
Completely contrasting my feelings on Not Such a Bad Boy, this is entirely the worst kind of throwaway.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I read somewhere that McCartney had a little bit of a Yesterday situation with this song, where it kind of came to him in a dream. And this whole film is one big dream sequence. The only conclusion I can draw is, and I've done some research into this, too much marijuana consumption stops REM sleep, which stops your dreams. And That's the only conclusion I can draw, that, you know, his dreams are so boring at this point because he's just too damn stoned. I also read that he felt like this song was akin to a Rolling Stones tune, but fuck me, Paul wishes this song was half as good as the Rolling Stones still sounded in 84. I mean, this is just a year after Undercover of Darkness, which is an incredible single.
Eight
Fathers' favourite song, so maybe that triggered me a little bit. I don't know. We do get a little reference to the Artful Dodger in this song, though, which is another Oliver Twist reference. How many Oliver Twist references are we going to bloody get in this film? But more on that later. During that song as well, we're also introduced to what I can only describe, Kit, as the biggest man I have ever seen. Like, people, you may have watched Game of Thrones and seen the mountain that rides. This is Mount Everest that rides. This man is a ginormous fellow. And I'm not just talking about girth. He is height, width, breadth. His hand is bigger than Paul McCartney's head. It is insane. But that shot of him walking menacingly towards the camera would have been effective if it hadn't been like 35 seconds long. Like, you're begging for him to reach the end of his destination by the time you actually introduce him in that shot. Paul imagines Harry selling the tapes to this dodgy looking kind of chap, and he speaks to him, reveals he too hasn't seen Harry. So once again, Chip, we have no drama.
Yep.
again. That's another daydream sequence. Like, why is there no Ferris Bueller's Day Off moment where someone says, hey, Paul, stop daydreaming?
Yeah, exactly.
If they had that, it would make so much sense.
Exactly. Yeah, he spends so much of his time daydreaming, he doesn't get anything done.
Not only that, his company is on the line, and he still goes about with his daily schedule.
And that doesn't seem to care that much.
Paul, you can put no values to one side for a minute. Like, maybe, like, look for the tapes? I don't know.
Yeah, exactly. You can skip no values. I mean, you know.
just get the Paul McCartney fan club. Get Club Sandwich to go out and look for it, you know?
Yeah, right.
I'm not going to lie, we're over an hour into this film, Kit, and we're still debating whether Harry stole the tapes or not.
Yeah.
This isn't an unresolved plot thread. This is a plot thread that is actively trying to piss me off.
Yeah, it's one of those movies where it's like you're, you know, in it and you're like, what is this about again?
Like, people talk about being bored, and, like, there's that awful anecdote of Roger Ebert having to tell Paul that this was a bad film, and I'm like,
oh,
because if I met Paul right now, Kit, do you know what I'd say? I love it, Paul.
Yeah,
amazing. Oh, you're so pretty, you know. I'd be such a sycophant. I would. I know,
me too. I wouldn't have the nerve.
Speaking of sycophants, Paul goes to an interview. And the interviewer reminds me of myself in a way, in the way that the moment they click pause, he goes, God, that's a piece of shit. Like, I love that. It was like, oh,
yeah,
loved it. But Kit, I mean, I know I might be a little bit young and wet behind the ears. How many radio broadcasts back in 84 had a live string quartet ready at the drop of a hat?
Yeah, that was awfully convenient, wasn't it?
Again, maybe spend the money paying off Rathbone, finding the tapes, whatever. Of course not.
Yeah. No.
1 hour and 9 minutes in, we get For No One, which, a.k.a. for me, is the best song on Revolver. Terrible remake. Pointless remake. It's like he's running through it for... like, against his will, almost. And it's like,
yeah,
chosen to do this. And I feel about this one the way you may have felt about Good Day Sunshine.
Yeah, I you know, not... Oh, oops, okay. Do you hear me?
I hear you. And we're still recording, we're all good.
Oh, do you hear me?
Still hear you, yeah.
Okay, that was weird. Headset went out for a second. Okay, it's back. So anyway, sorry about that. So, okay, back to For No One. All right. Okay, sorry about that. I don't know why that happened. Okay, For No One. His vocals are just, yeah, as you said, he just sounds like he's just kind of going through the motions, and which is so strange. I don't know why. I mean, obviously you can skip this version. I mean, the original is so far superior. It's ridiculous. I don't know why, because I agree. It's one of my favorites too. I think it's one of his finest compositions. And, to run through it with such little, I mean, I don't know if energy is the right, you know, the right term to use. This is not quite energy, but just no feeling to it. And I mean, this is one version that you could definitely skip. And it's just so odd that he would, you know, sing it in such a, you know, impassionate kind of, you know, indifferent kind of way. I mean, it's just so strange. This was one remake I don't think he should have bothered doing.
Where's the piano, Kit? Where's the piano? Where's Wallace String? Telling this, I can remember back when I was in year 8, so that would be like the 10th grade or 9th grade in America. I was probably about 14, 15.
Sure.
And I just had a major breakup, my first major breakup. One of my friends, Matt O'Connor, who to this day is about 10'3". He's the tallest guy I've ever met.
Wow.
And, he just had a breakup as well with a girl who's about 2'2". they were a great couple. And we were both depressed at a party. We were both getting through a bottle of JB or Jameson's. It was definitely a green whiskey bottle, I remember. So upset, and I was a bit dejected, and I put on For No One, and just cut to these two mid-teens just crying their eyes out.
Oh.
Finding, why doesn't she love me, man? Why doesn't she love me?
Oh. But yeah, that's what it's supposed to, you know. I mean, that's what it's supposed to elicit. I mean, that's it. I mean, it's an incredibly sad song. And then yeah, he just sits there, like, your day breaks, your mind aches. I mean, yeah, like, why doesn't he? It's like he's looking at his watch.
Got a joint with my name on it. Come on, can we wrap up the film here? California Kush waiting for me. Then at the 1 hour and 12 minute mark, we get Eleanor Rigby and Eleanor's Dream. I had read so much about this infamous Eleanor's Dream sequence.
Yeah.
Dream sequence, do you get it? And
got it.
Hey, what I did there. And this is a dream. Everyone seems to flag it off. Everyone seems to get it. And well, just okay. Let me address the music.
Mm-hmm.
A sequel to Eleanor Rigby on paper should not work.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, the remake is incredibly competent. It doesn't have the same immediacy or spectacle of the original. Like the I swear the mix in Yellow Submarine is different. Beatles say otherwise. I swear it's a slightly different mix. But the remake we get here is solid, and they develop and expand on the idea of Eleanor Rigby in a way that I was not expecting. And I'd heard the whole Eleanor's Dream sequence before I'd seen the film. And in the way that, you know, you get a real kick out of seeing then and saying, Queen says no to pot-smoking FBI agents in the Let It Be documentary, you know, seeing that visual link up to the visuals. That was magical for me.
Mm-hmm. It is. It really, yeah, the score and everything does work amazingly well. I mean, you don't, and you agree, it shouldn't work, right? I mean, it shouldn't work on paper, but it's beautiful. You know, it's George Martin, of course. I mean, just scores it beautifully. And it really does follow the story of the song very well. I mean, the mood of the song, the storyline, they really took, I mean, not that I thought they would just knock this out in 2 minutes, but I mean, they really took great care in crafting the song to really go along with the mood, the storyline, you know, it's surprisingly effective, and so yeah, I mean, the remake is good in itself, but then to, you know, carry it into the dream sequence and the score, yeah, I agree, it's really, and listening to it again, you know, preparation for the show, I'd forgotten how, you know, truly, you know, intricate and lovely it really is.
I do want to point out that there's at least one part that I feel like is a direct homage to The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky. That kind of anyone who knows Fantasia and the bit with the dinosaurs,
mm-hmm.
That is The Rite of Spring, and that really runs that. And when Harry is stabbed by Rathbone, spoiler alert, that has echoes of Bernard Herrmann's score for Psycho, which is a definite
yes
allusion. It has to be.
Yes, that is true. I'd forgotten that part. Yeah, absolutely. And of course, that makes sense because that was an inspiration in the score for the original Eleanor Rigby, as I recall. I think George Martin's talked about that in previous interviews. So, yeah, I mean, it was an amazingly effective score and, you know, really, as I said, built upon the storyline of the lyrics. So yeah, that was definitely a highlight of the soundtrack. Absolutely.
We've got about 20 minutes to talk about the visuals here now, because a lot to get through.
Yes, indeed.
A cold-hearted, overly negative, millennial, contrarian cynic like myself, Kim, had his heart melted. The Elmer's Dream sequence. Again, I'd heard loads about it, and I was like, I don't know what these people saw, because this, to me, is just a visual representation of things like Wonderful Christmas Time, Alec and Tyre, and So Bad, that kind of silly Paul doing his thing. And it's, you know, it's like, you know when he, like, made Walking Through the Park with Eloise, and you're like, oh, my dad would like it. Paul's dad would have loved this scene. Dapper with his little whiskers, and Ringo's rocking some amazing outfits as well. As it's another great. It's got an out of touch, ridiculous innocence that I cannot help but hope. The back of the Rolls Royce stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, if Paul's going to be a toff, why not make fun of it? You know. Even in the dream sequence, Paul has someone carrying his stuff around for him, you know. Oh, he has to help.
It's true.
And then, you know, we get a waterfall sequence, because, of course, there's a waterfall.
Of course.
Not a reference to the song Waterfall, sadly. Like, couldn't they have hired a polar bear? Yeah. and watching Linda act scared, that was a delight. They'll just like it, because it's the worst bit of acting since Barbara Bach. Oh, my God. Hey, Linda, you're a photographer, right? Yes. So I'm going to make you be a keyboard player and an actress. Oh. Just let her do her cookbook with too much cream in it, please. We cut to a Winter Wonderland. That was a great one-off visual as like a transition between the tough stuff, and then we move to a Victorian street, aka the Warner Brothers backlot set, and again we have a lot more allusions to Oliver, not Oliver Twist the book, literally the David Lean film Oliver, which Kit to me is my favourite musical of all time. You ask me to sing any song from that movie, I will do it note for well, not note for note, but I'll do it word for word. And I mean, one of my favourite songs from the Oliver play is Bill Sykes' song that is actually cut from the film. It's called My Name, and it's just him talking about how he loves murdering people and stuff. And I was always upset that never was shown. But we do get a little facsimile of Bill Sykes in this, complete with a barking dog, and I felt there was wonderful shades of Oliver Reed here, but he's played by the big man from the warehouse sequence, and then Harry gets stabbed by Rathbone, and I was like, wow, that's violent for a Paul McCartney movie. Wow,
yeah.
That's a murder. Obviously, there's no blood.
No.
But the actor playing Harry, he's going for the Oscar with his dying. Oh, like stumbling and falling over. But this whole sequence, Kit, to me, is a highlight of one of the main problems of the film. Paul just watches stuff happening. He is passive as hell. He is not a player in his own story. To quote John Lennon about Help, we weren't even the main characters in our own film. Paul is the main character in his own film. He doesn't do anything. Save Harry! Go save him! It's your dream! It's your dream, Paul! It's your script! You don't have to... Like, have you ever heard of lucid dreaming?
The, that's true. I mean, even when, well, though, I guess I don't know. Well, I guess he could have tried something. But yeah, when Ringo and Barbara and Linda are going, you know, are going over the waterfall. And yeah, he just stands there. And they're all like, help, help, help. And he's just standing there. like, can't you grab a boat, go in there or swim or something? Oh, no, he just stands there.
Oh, no. Yeah. Dabbling, you know? I'd pay good money to see Barbara Back be hit by an oar in the face like a javelin. Yeah. I think that'd be a very good scene. Like, it's really, like, graphically violent. Like, it's completely inappropriate. Like,
Oh, my God.
Barbara, hold your nose up. Hold your nose up, love.
Oh, man. But I did love the picnic part. I was like, I'd love to be at that picnic. 100%. That looked really, yes. That looked fabulous, didn't it?
There must be a paid experience wherever that was shot. You know, the give my regards to Broadstreet experience.
Yeah. Like, I would do that.
Then come over to England, kid, and we'll go on the go row a boat over a waterfall, you know.
Well, we could skip that part. The picnic I'm down, but you know, we could skip the waterfall and the stabbing.
To fall in a stabbing is like the name of my autobiography.
Yeah, there you go.
Then, after this dream sequence, Paul suddenly decides to become an active agent in his own bloody movie.
Yeah, finally. Again,
this should be the part where Gandalf gives Frodo the ring after 30 minutes and the adventure begins. But then you look at the clock and you're like, we've got like 10 minutes left. Okay, let's see what happens here. And for some reason, Kit, we get the studio album version at 1 hour 25 of Band on the Run.
Yeah.
Which doesn't appear on the soundtrack and wasn't remade. But apparently it was remade, but there has been no release of it at all. Apparently it had Ringo on drums as well. And my favourite thing to type in on YouTube or Vimeo is Paul McCartney sessions and just seeing what comes up. Because, I mean, I am knee-deep in the Phil Ramone sessions. I'm loving me some Big Day and Atlantic Ocean. Return to Pepperland. Like, all of that is well up my alley because, again, it's obscure and contrarian. Paul's driving through in his imaginary speedster car again. I'm glad that got another little like T-Rex at the end of Jurassic Park. Give the audience what they want there, Paul, you know. Then he goes to a pub that Harry was last seen at, and he chats to the landlord, who in any other script would be like the wise old sage type who would actually give Paul useful advice, but he just has a pet monkey and tells him about how poets don't always appear as they look.
Yeah, that was the strangest scene. I mean, yeah, that's what I was waiting for. I was waiting for the man, Ralph Richardson, the famous British actor, who apparently this was one of his final films. I think he died not long before the movie came out. And
we all know he saw the film and, you know, he took things in his own hands.
Yeah, exactly. And you're waiting for him to give Paul sage advice, right? You know, where to find Harry, or he's going to say something where Paul is going to suddenly, like, a light bulb will go out, you know, on over his head. No, he just says a bunch of, you know, things that, you know, just a lot of, I don't know, abstract kind. I mean, they just sort of talk around each other. And he gives his pet monkey a little, you know, little teacup and everything. And then Paul leaves. That's it.
The fact that, I mean, I don't want to jump too far ahead, obviously. I don't want to be like, Paul, there's so many dream sequences in the podcast, but in 2 minutes, we're going to see Paul go, oh, yeah, Broadstreet Station. So why didn't the the old landlord say, oh, Harry left singing Give My Regards to Broadway. Like, if he had just said that, it would make sense.
Yeah.
Why Paul would go, oh, he's at Broad Street Station. But no.
No.
He just leaves after, oh, Kit, this film does not do anything for the stereotype that British people drink tea. They're at a pub. Have a pint. I mean, obviously Paul can't drink and drive, but you know.
And you all keep pet monkeys, right?
Yeah. Hang on. Down, boy. Down. Oh, sorry. Ace Ventura in here. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Oh, what I did notice though, and it's the only fun reference that I really would. I like that. The chime on the landlord's clock are the opening notes from Let 'Em In.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, yeah, so that was, okay, that was cute.
And I'm like, Kit, were you expecting two references to Wings at the Speed of Sound? We get nothing from Abbey Road, nothing from Ram, nothing from Rubber Soul. Like, but Wings at the Speed of Sound, like, I was half expecting him to do a remake of The Note You Never Wrote.
Well, better than no values.
Come on. I mean, I would love to hear Paul on lead vocal for something like Wino Junko when he's booked. Yeah.
Oh, man.
At the 1 hour and 30 minute mark, we get the long and winding road. Fuck the saxophone. Oh my god, I hate this kit. I never used the H word. I hate it, hate it, hate it, hate it, hate it. And I'm the only person on earth who prefers Lennon's bad bass line than Herbie Flower's new bass line. Like I love Thrillington and that's great bass on it, but Lennon does a better job here. And hey, Paul, you did a worse job than Phil Spector.
Well, yeah, that was really funny that Paul, of course, was saying how much he hated, you know, Phil Spector's, production work on that and the singers and all. And so what does Paul do?
Have the saxophone.
And
it's the 80s. It's the 80s bingo card again, isn't it?
So yeah.
Tick that off.
Yep, exactly. So, I mean, yeah, it's kind of funny, that he then did that stuff to it. So, yeah, it's funny. And, yeah, my favorite in that scene where he's driving around is, you know, when he's driving down the tawdry street where the hookers are and everything. Yeah. I love that part.
Hookers try and solicit him in the in the Victorian Eleanor's dream sequence as well.
Yeah.
What's Linda thinking about all this? Because for anyone who likes the behind the scenes, one of Paul's ex-girlfriends visited him on set as well. And
oh my god!
Like, what, Paul? Like, put it in your pants, man. Like, Ringo's a sex pest. You're being approached by hookers. This
I don't know. I think he should have retitled this film Paul's Midlife Crisis. I think that should have been.
It would make a lot more sense, wouldn't it?
Wouldn't it? Yeah, with the car and everything. Yeah, for sure.
We cut to Tracy Ullman crying in bed. Do you remember her?
Yep.
I don't. Oh, what? Cyndi Lauper's in this. I forgot. Oh. Girls do not have fun.
No, not in this movie.
So, like I mentioned, without any prompt or motivation to do so, Paul just goes, oh yeah, Harry's on his way to Broad Street Station. Again, would have been nice to have had that scene earlier, but no.
Well, he remembers, which is also bizarre, that when I guess they gave Harry the tapes, that they bizarrely sang him off by singing Give My Regards to Broad Street, I guess. Because I guess he said to them, well, I'm off to Broad Street Station. And a bunch of them saying, oh, give my regards to Broad Street. And then he says, then Paul, the light bulb goes off. So, yeah. So that was his epiphany. Why he didn't think of this before?
I don't know. I mean, I'm not about gentrification, but when Paul walked around Broad Street Station, it looks like New York in the 80s. Like, it looks like Times Square. Again, another reference to a Joaquin Phoenix's Joker here, but, you know, it looks like the worst station ever. I'm like, I'm glad they tore this piece of shit station down. It looks awful and depressing and run down. Great name for your movie, Paul.
Yeah, I mean, I was last in London in 2000. I was there 2000, and I'd love to go back. I'm hoping to go back sometime. And I'm like, I don't remember seeing a station like that.
Like, the tourist board must have had a fit when they saw that.
Yeah. Yeah, wow.
And while he's walking around at the 1 hour 35 minute mark, we get No More Lonely Nights. This is our final original song on the soundtrack, and of course it was the main single. It's a power ballad. They got to number two here in England and Ireland, and only number six over there in the States. But as we mentioned earlier, number six was a hit back then.
Yes.
I mean, a lot of radio play, I take it.
Lot of radio play, and I do, as I said, I remember seeing the video. I have the 45 of it. I mean, it got a lot of play, and it was I love that song. I still do. That David Gilmour guitar solo. I just thought it was certainly one of his finest 80s singles, that's for sure. I still enjoy that song. And it was, even as a 12-year-old kid, I gravitated toward that song, even though I, you know, wasn't a full Beatle fan yet. I thought his vocals were really strong on that. And I loved the, you know, explosive chorus. George Martin, I thought excellent production work on that. Just a really strong song. I've always liked it.
I've got to be honest, Kit. I don't like this song.
That's okay. Well, and part of it for me is also kind of sentimental, because I absolutely remember, you know, buying the single, and, you know, so some of it's sentimental for me.
I actually think that the solo in No Values is better than this one. And I love David Gilmour. I think David Gilmour on paper is probably the most successful collaborator of Paul in the 80s. Hit ratio. My best friend Danny, who designed the thumbnail for this podcast, this is his favourite Paul McCartney song. He listens to Heart FM, which is the 80s station here in the UK. I don't like power ballads at the best of times, and, you know, this is not my kind of McCartney. I don't like Once Upon a Long Ago from this era either. This kind of middle-of-the-road macker rubs me the wrong way. And I just kind of think, look, Paul, just go back to making weird McCartney 2-esque shit, you know? Just go back to the weird. Stop trying to make money and appeal to everyone. Be niche and unpopular so that I can like you legitimately. He's not giving me what I want, Kit. He's not giving me what I want. He's being too damn good, but it's just not what I consider to be that moving. Then we actually get to the scene that everyone and their mum talks about. We're saying what their favourite scene from this film is. Oh my God, Sam, the best scene's Paul busking. Oh my God. Everyone on my Twitter was going mental over this scene. I mean, maybe this was the inspiration for Move Over Busker. Get a little shot of Paul doing a little skiffle version of Yesterday. And I've got to admit, it's pretty fun. I wish it had been incorporated more throughout the film, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it is. It's funny. It is funny. Yeah, I agree. It should have been more than 10 seconds. I mean, yeah, if that had been kind of a running joke through the film or something, you know, that could have been funnier. That's true. Yeah, to just kind of shoehorn it in at the last second for no apparent reason.
Best as well.
Yeah.
I mean, any fans of Alan Moore's Watchmen will be aware of the character of Rorschach, Walter Kovacs, and he's a homeless man who you see throughout the narrative, and getting a little bit of inspiration from that. There should have been a homeless character who Paul constantly saw throughout the film, and it's just a guy who looks like him. You know, in the way that if you go back in time and visit your great-great-grandfather, he looks exactly like you and he's played by the same actor. It should, it should have just been like that, you know?
Yeah.
Someone who Paul meets on the street. I mean, if he was alive, it would probably have been Lennon.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that could have been more entertaining. But yeah, just to kind of, as I said, sort of shoehorn it in at the last minute, that, yeah, that was kind of weird. But that could have been a funny, you know, running gag or something. But you know, as with everything in the movie, no. No, they didn't.
The Deus Ex Machina of stumbling across the tapes on the platform bench. He then follows his nose and discovers Harry's trapped in a closet. Not the same closet that Tom Cruise is in, just an actual... And they laugh, and it's all resolved. Oh, I thought I was locked in the toilet, Paul. Kit, have you ever seen a gross-out dude bro comedy called The Hangover?
I haven't seen the whole thing, but I know of it, yeah.
It's the same ending! It's just, oh, he's somewhere we didn't look before.
Yeah! And I just, I remember the first time I saw this, and then, you know, seeing it again now, you just, the end, you're just like, that's it. I just spent the last hour and a half or whatever it is of this, and that's it. You know, all this with the tapes, and that's the solution.
Well, ironically as well, the guy who directed Hangover actually went on to direct Joker, so I get to mention that movie again. I can't help but feel like this should have been a reveal at the end of the first act again. Folks, I love structure. You know, 10 minutes in, you meet the main character. 15 minutes in, he saves the cat to win you over. At 30-minute mark, you have your inciting incident. These things work. These things are how movies are made. And Paul is not a screenwriter.
No. And
that Rathbone didn't have a henchman who locked Harry in the closet, and then Paul and Harry had to, you know, get the tapes for the rest of the movie, is it's pathetic how little is going on here.
Yeah.
And then, oh, maybe, like, you know, Rathbone's going to send some guys to rough Paul and Harry up, and they're going to fight their way out in a little closing fight. No, they just ring them.
I mean,
the tapes. Fuck off. Kit, I know you don't swear, but I'll say it for you. Fuck right off.
I mean, yeah, it is the most anticlimactic, you know. I mean, it's just, you're just like, I spent, as I said, an hour and a half, whatever it is, for this. Wow.
I just compose myself a little bit because I'm actually getting quite sweaty with how angry I'm getting right now.
Oh, no.
I'm quite worked up over this. This is because, Kit, despite the fact that I run a music podcast, I am a film guy first, and my respect for film means I'd never do a podcast about it because I just don't know enough. But I can blag my way to a music podcast. Obviously, the whole premise of this show is that I'm not pulled. So I do get to experience this for the first time as it is. And, the best bit of how this whole sequence is Linda gets a line of dialogue, ladies and gentlemen.
Finally.
I'll tell them that's it. I love her voice. I love her accent. But, you know, then again, I love Yoko's accent. I love Olivia Harrison's accent. Don't like Barbara Bach's, but whatever.
Yeah.
And then after all of this is resolved, Kit, we get the worst... Have you ever read Alice in Wonderland?
Yes.
It was all a dream all along!
I know.
Tim Burton, eat your heart out. Where's Johnny Depp do the Frabjous Day dance when you need him? You know what I mean?
Yep. Oh yes. It was all a dream cliche. I mean, yep.
At least it wasn't Tom Waits' Alice. That's a much darker prospect.
Yes.
a bit of a jabber cocky, you know what I mean? This is not a very good ending at all. It's a waste of time. It's a stab in the audience's eye. I'm angry, Kit. I am. I'm thinking about it now. And then Paul enters Abbey Road and you're begging for a rooftop concert. You're begging for something like that.
Yep.
And then it just credits come up. And like you said, is that it?
Yep.
Oh, okay. At the 1 hour 44 minute mark, we get No More Lonely Nights play out version. Only 9 minutes since we last heard the bastard song. Why wasn't No More Lonely Nights at the start of the movie? Like, Paul, you know what a reprise is, right? You know how good a decent reprise can be.
Yep.
And you ballsed it up. You massively ballsed it up, and it leaves me on... It's like a lemon and a lime in terms of its sourness in my opinion. I'm getting a lot of vitamin C, but, you know, it's just not worth it in the end.
Yep, I know. Yeah, it's bad, just... Bad. Yep, again, you're just like, well, that's an hour and a half or whatever. I won't get back.
No, you're not going to get back. I mean, the only decent thing in the credits is that you see Steve Shrimpton and Lee Eastman getting a little thank you.
Yes, indeed. Absolutely. And, I mean, it's just, you know, again, it's an example, and you would think that Paul would have learned it from Magical Mystery Tour, but no, that, you know, you not just anybody can write a screenplay. And I mean, you know, he should have. And I think he did. I read somewhere that he did approach another screenwriter. And I think it sounded like the screenwriter tried to say, gosh, Paul, these are interesting ideas, but, you know.
22 pages, Kit. And for anyone not in the know, a page generally equals 1 minute of screen time.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Even with all the song sequences, it adds up to about 60. Mm-hmm. That explains the 35 minutes of filler we get, I guess.
Yeah, I think so. And so, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, you may have a great idea for a storyline and all, but I mean, you need to work with somebody who really understands, you know, cinematography, who understands, as you said, you know, how to develop a plot line. I mean, you know, not just anybody can sit down and write that. And I mean, as I said, I'm one of them. I'm not going to do it. And so I think that, you know, maybe Paul learned his lesson after this, and really, it's but you know, there were some good songs that came out of the soundtrack, and so there it was. And the soundtrack did well, you know, it did well on the charts. But of course, after this came out, the the reviews were savage. I mean, absolutely savage, and the box office was, you know, was really, really poor.
You have to have a tube of burn cream when you read the reviews.
Oh my God.
But look, like, Kit, I love a nice, like, horrendously over-the-top, unnecessarily harsh, like, quip where, you know, it'll be something like, "Ooh, I'm glad Paul wasted the bank's money and not his." Stuff like that. But... folks, I mean, I will have gone through this in the opening 30 minutes where I do my little context, but my God, they savaged him. Like, it's like Jodie Foster in The Unforgiven. It's awful.
It really is. But he still, he did a whole press tour, and he did. And quick story. I mentioned this too before we went on air, but by back in, I guess this would have been 84, a former babysitter of mine, her father was a photographer for the Chicago Tribune, and Paul was coming through town to promote this, and Gene Siskel of Siskel and Ebert, you know, they were the, he and Roger Ebert were the
Siskel, the thin, bald one, yeah?
Yes, he was the thin, bald one, yep. Yeah, they were the film critics in America. I mean, they were the top of the time, you know. And so Paul was coming through town to promote this, and Gene Siskel was going to interview him. Now, I don't know at this point if Siskel had seen the movie. I'm not sure. But he, you know, this was just going to be a promotional interview. And so Susie convinced her father to let her come along. She was a huge fan. She was in high school probably at this point. So she was a huge Beatle fan. In fact, one of her brothers was in a touring company of Beatlemania. From the, remember that show from the 70s, the stage show? There was a, it was like a musical. But anyway, so she came. And it was at a hotel in downtown Chicago. He was doing tons of interviews, you know. And so so she comes, and she meets Paul. Of course, she's probably like the rest of us, saying, hi, Paul. And, you know, probably like any of us would be, tongue-tied.
What's his name? The chap who sadly passed away. What's his name?
Oh, Chris Farley.
Yeah,
like Chris Farley. Yep, probably was like Chris Farley. So then, you know, she sits off in a corner and all. So Gene Siskel starts interviewing Paul and starts asking him really obvious questions. I mean, questions that he had been asked like 1,000 times. And
where do your ideas come from, Paul? Where do your ideas come from?
Oh, like really obvious stuff.
What's that about?
Yeah. And
well, it's about my mom, actually.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, same old stuff. And Susie's in the corner, you know, and she starts smirking, you know. And Paul sees her out of the corner of his eye. And he starts smirking because he knows exactly what she's laughing about. And Siskel sees all this and says, get her out of here. And so her father, Tony, begged, could I just get one picture of my daughter with Paul, you know, before she goes, you know. So they said, okay. So I have it. And I couldn't, I'll have to find it, but I have a copy of the picture. They gave it to me years later. And it's a picture of the two of them sitting on a couch where he's, and of course she's looking like, you know, beyond thrilled. And so then, you know, she had to leave, but it was really funny because I guess Siskel was just asking him the same old tired questions and Susie knew, you know, and so it was just funny that Paul saw her smirking, and he started smirking right back, you know, like, yeah, I know, these are the same old tired questions.
Susie didn't open a parlor after, did she?
And so I don't know, she didn't. I wish.
Or was she called Susie Parker? Who knows, you know?
Yeah, who knows? Who knows? Oh, that's funny. But anyway, so yeah, so he was doing all that kind of stuff. And, you know, God love him. He still did all that. And he hasn't done a movie since, of course.
Which is a shame. Like, if he just went, you know, hey, Marty Scorsese, you know, can you just do this thing for me? Like, it'd be great. It just would. But the lack of control he would have to give and giving final cut to someone else, you know, it's like giving Michael Lindsay Hogg the final cut for Let It Be and showing the Beatles to be.
Yep, I don't know if he could do. I mean, the Let It Be project, that'll be interesting to see next year, of course, when that comes out.
If it comes out, Kate.
Yeah, right. We'll see. Oh, I guess we'll believe it when we see it.
I mean, like, it was meant to come out the day after my birthday, Kate.
That really hurts.
I think that's the worst thing that's happened because of Corona, me having my birthday ruined. It's not the thousands and thousands of dead. That's not staying in the cut, by the way. That's a joke just for you, by the way.
Okay.
if you are looking for, you know, unproblematic Beatles podcasts, I am sure Nothing Is Real will gladly have you on next week.
That's funny.
American podcasts, Irish podcasts. Give us my land back, you podcast stealing mother. My father stole that land and I want it back.
That's right. That's funny.
Before I unleash into another classic Paul or Nothing style rant that will make Larry David blush. What are your closing thoughts, general review, and professional recommendation for Paul McCartney's super flop called Give My Regards to Broadstreet?
All right. Well, you know, if you're obviously a hardcore fan, you have to see it. You know, I wouldn't say the casual fan may not enjoy it as much.
I didn't mean to laugh that. I really didn't.
That's okay. No. I mean, that's the thing. I don't know if I would say the casual fan absolutely has to see it. But the hardcore fan, I mean, you do have to see it. And whenever it comes out, on DVD, Blu-ray, whatever. You'd have to have it as part of your collection. It's definitely not a great artistic statement. It's one that you'll probably enjoy the soundtrack more than the film. It's also kind of a snapshot of a certain period in Paul's career, where he was sort of trying to find his footing in the contemporary landscape, as we talked about earlier. He would eventually find it more in the late 80s, but it's still it's definitely it was not. It deserves its reputation for being a critical disappointment. Hasn't aged well, but it's still worth a look if you are a hardcore Paul fan, particularly, just to see what this period in his career was like. You want the soundtrack for your collection for completest reasons. And for certain tracks like Not Such a Bad Boy and particularly No More Lonely Nights.
Are there any minor fixes you could add to this film to improve it? Or does it need to be completely reworked from the ground?
Oh, it needs to be completely reworked. Oh, no. It's not minor fixes. It needs to be completely reworked. Absolutely.
You hear these things like it was a TV special about Tug of War, and that would have been way better, but no.
Yeah, I'm trying to think if there would be any way you could just do some minor reworking. I mean, maybe it would have been okay. I've said this about Magical Mystery Tour. Like, Magical Mystery Tour would have been great, in my humble opinion, if you had just taken out all the musical sequences. You know, forget the other stuff. Take out the musical sequences and have it be like a video album. I think that would have been, it would have worked on that level. With Give My Regards to Broadstreet, I don't know if it would have, I mean, maybe the Eleanor's Dream sequence. That was probably one of the more interesting parts of the film. But I'm trying to think if it could even work on just like a musical, you know, like a video album level. But geez, I don't know.
It had existed in 1984, and he could have put ad revenue on all the music videos. He probably would have at least broke even.
Yeah.
Revenue on big YouTube videos, like, I'm going to assume that Paul would have some pull still in 84 if YouTube had existed in the format back then.
Yeah, because Paul's still, in 84 he certainly would have, you know, he was still charting hits then. So, I mean, he probably would have still had some pull then to do that, do a, you know, or do a, have to hate to bring a, you know, bring this, weird to bring this artist up on this broadcast, but like a Beyonce and do like a video album like that.
I tell you what, I love Beyonce, Kit.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good.
She has the balls to fuck off after each album and just leave you wanting more. She does not bombard you in the way that, like, an Ariana Grande does, where every day there's a new story about Ariana Grande. Beyonce releases an album, it's amazing, all the singles are good, and then she goes away and makes you miss her.
Yes.
Absolutely love it. I wish Lady Gaga would do something similar as well.
Yep, that's true. That's true. And yeah, that's the thing. And her video albums are, you know, really well done. Very innovative and all that. So, I mean, you know, maybe on something like that level, it could have worked. I don't know. But or the equivalent back in 84. But yeah, I think, I mean, otherwise, yeah, the movie would need some major reworking.
Who runs the world? Girls. Hey, I'm coming in hard, Kit.
Yeah.
Right. Sit back. I'm going to eviscerate this movie and tear it a new asshole. This is genuinely one of the worst movies I've ever seen in my entire life. Yeah. I like bad movies. I love movies like 1992's Spiders. I love Drunken Samurai and kung fu movies. And I love straight-to-video alien movies. And stuff. I like bad movies. This is not a film. People are like, oh, this is Paul McCartney's home movies. I wish it was Paul McCartney's home movies, because in Paul McCartney's home movies, we get a version of Bebop and, you know, I Am Your Singer mixed together and stuff like that. You know, we get great stuff. Here, I would kill for Heart of the Country and just footage of Linda and Paul on a horse.
Yep.
No, we get a movie where Paul suffers from a term I've coined called Batman Syndrome, where the main character is the most uninteresting character in his own story. And it's like, oh my God, Paul, you would not do this movie propagates so many terrible stereotypes of Paul being this upper-class rich twit. It's into this day, the story. Paul is 100% passive in his own movie. He doesn't do anything. The whole script is a first act with a resolution tacked on the end. There is no second act. There is no build-up. There are no stakes we care about. And as cliche as it sounds, I kind of would have liked a Three Stooges or Laurel and Hardy type plot where he's got to save an orphanage or something, you know? Something I can relate to. Supporting cast bar Ringo are all underutilized and terribly boring and one note. Again, shout out to Tracy Ullman, you got a rough deal there, love. Few to none of the jokes land on their two feet.
Ow.
And the ending resolution is, honestly, it's as funny as it is unsatisfying. And the film is almost embarrassed by its own crap ending, and it like really speedily gets it over with, you know.
Yeah.
Out of give this a rating out of 10 or a Rotten Tomatoes score percentage out of 100. Go on.
Oh, man. I guess, for out of 10, I'd give this a 2.
And would you give it 22% or is it a firm 20?
Oh my God. I don't know if I'd have the heart to give it a 20. I'd probably give it a 22.
All right, yeah. You know, just under 4 stars, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, to quote Roger Ebert talking about the Elijah Wood film North, I hated it. Hated it. And massive shout out to Siskel and Ebert on this podcast. I love the fact that they are in Godzilla, the 1997 Godzilla film.
Yeah.
The best criticism they had towards that movie was, if you're going to put us in a Godzilla movie, have him stomp on us.
Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, as I said, love Paul and you know, love much of his work. And I mean, obviously I'm a fan, but yeah, this was just not, you know, not up to his standards, to say the least.
Right, Kit, I'm not going to make you do a Ken Michaels length episode. I'm going to let you go in the next 10 minutes. We have one last little tradition here. It's called
All Cat Right. Letter,
where we select three songs that will be added to the official Paul McCartney, Paul or Nothing canon. Now, I would normally request we choose original tracks here, but there are only three original tracks, and some of the remakes are actually pretty damn good. So, between the two of us, we're going to choose three songs. Let's choose one each. And then one that we will try and hash out between us. What song do you want to unequivocally add to the Paul McCartney canon?
Okay, now this is, because I didn't hear part of that. So this is, so these are songs just from any of his solo albums, or?
I'll retake all that. So before we go, we have another little tradition here on the show called Canon Fodder, where we're going to select three songs from the soundtrack, and we're going to add it to the Paul or Nothing canon playlist that covers the entire breadth of Paul McCartney's career. Normally, I would choose original tracks, but obviously the Give My Regards to Broadstreet soundtrack only has three original tracks, and some of the remakes are pretty good. So between us, we're going to choose three songs from the Give My Regards to Broadstreet soundtrack. We're going to choose one each that the other can't veto, and then we'll decide the third between ourselves. I'm going to start off with Not Such a Bad Boy. That has to be added to the canon, even if it is a complete throwaway. Kit, choose one song from this soundtrack.
Okay, well, you're not going to like this, but No More Lonely Nights.
I mean, it's fine. Don't worry.
Sorry about that.
I'm still Catholic. I'm good at forgiveness. I really am. Now, this is the difficult bit, but Not Such a Bad Boy and No More Lonely Nights. What are we going to choose for the third song? I mean, the three I'd like to throw into the mix would be Eleanor Rigby, Eleanor's Dream, Ballroom Dancing, or So Bad. But I know that you're not a big fan of So Bad compared to the album version.
Yeah. Hmm.
Let's bargain. Come on. Come on. Let's talk.
Okay. Yeah, I would vote for Ballroom Dancing because I like the extra verse. And as I said, the you know, I think the instrumental break on this version really kicks butt. So that would be my vote.
You know what? But Eleanor's Dream is so good.
Yeah, Eleanor's Dream, that's true.
What coin somewhere? Oh, I love a 10 pence piece right now, or 10 cents to my American listeners. No, come on. Okay, the fact that Ballroom Dancing was the first song that I ever saw on YouTube for Paul McCartney, and I saw this video possibly just a twinkle in my eye. Let's go with Ballroom Dancing. So the final
Yay!
Is Cannon Fodder. We're going to go with Not Such a Bad Boy. We're going to go with Ballroom Dancing. Not the play-out version, I hope.
No. The regular version. Single version.
Yeah, we'll go with No More Lonely Nights. Go on. And Kit, to wrap things up, let me just say, all networking and bullshit aside, thank you for coming on this show. Well, clearly, it's been worth the wait. I've kept my mom up with the laughter. And I will definitely be asking you back on this show as soon as possible. Maybe even for the James Paul McCartney TV special. Who knows?
Oh!
Do you have anything coming up that you want to plug or talk about to my eight listeners?
your eight listeners. Well, first of all, Sam, I had a blast. I'm glad we finally got this together. I mean, this was just such a great time. I had such fun discussing this with you. And no, this, you know, I know you thought I was going to be mad that you gave me Broadstreet, but I wasn't. This was such a fun to revisit, and it took me back to my youth. So this was really this was a fun assignment. So coming up, actually on Talk More Talk, my next show with many of my co-hosts that you've had on this show, and I'm just checking my calendar here. It is July 13th. We'll be back with another episode where we are going to do a brand new show. We haven't tried this before. We're calling it Rack Our Brain.
Can't do a single thing on a Beatles podcast without it being the title of one of their songs.
Yeah, of course, we have to do it, where we are going to ask each other sort of lightning round questions, where we're going to ask each other sort of instant opinions of, you know, if you had to choose like a song to knock off of, you know, Red Rose Speedway, what would it be? You know, things like that. And we're going to ask the audience to ask us questions as well. So this should be a lot of fun. So that's going to be July 13th, 9 p.m. Eastern. So just go to Facebook and go to our Facebook page, Talk More Talk Solo Beatles Videocast, and join the fun. And of course, if you can't join us live, you can watch us on YouTube and listen to our audio version as well. I'm also going to be back on the Plastic EP show. In fact, I think the latest episode I was on is just going up. And of course, you can check my Facebook page either at Kiddo Tools Keynotes or my other page, just Kiddo Tool. And I'm always posting any other appearances, such as on this show and plenty of others, and my latest writings and that kind of thing. You can follow me on those pages and find out what I'm up to and where what shows I'm on, where my writings are, and all that fun stuff. So just follow me there or on my website, kiddotool.com.
To quote the Avengers Endgame, I bow before your majestic personage, Kid.
Thank you, Sam. Really appreciate it. I had a great time.
As you know, everyone, my fans, my eight fans, make sure you do listen to Talk More Talk. You all put on a fantastic show there. And
Thank you. You
also gave me a shout out during a very difficult point in my life, that touched my heart massively.
Oh,
you guys really are the Avengers of the Beatles podcasting world. And I was listening to another kind of mind. They were talking about genius clusters. That's what Talk More Talk is to me. It's a genius cluster of all of my favorite podcasters and Tom Hunyadi.
Thank you very much. I love it. The Avengers. I think that might be our new nickname. I like that.
Tom, just so you know, I only take the piss out of you because you had the balls to do a Paul McCartney podcast the same year I did. always got a chance to swap to Ringo. You've always got a chance to swap.
Ringo Andy, or nothing.
Andy, convince him, you know, maybe. Everyone, that was the Queen. Her Majesty's a pretty nice girl. She has a lot to say. That was our review of Give My Regards to Broadstreet. I've been your host, Sam Wiles. That was my guest, the powerful Dr. Kit O'Toole. Thank you for tuning in. Not sure if this is coming out before Flowers in the Dirt or after. Either way, stick around. We'll see you very soon. Take care. Bye-bye. Much love.